all, shoveling dirt in every hole. Predators to condemn your soul, watching you and watching me. We're all connected but separated, misunderstood and so frustrated. A million armies of one have invaded, watching you and watching me. We live behind glass curtains and act like nothing's wrong. Soon you will be long. To make headlines, be immortalized. Everyone's got an electric eye with the digital spies. People are little brother, standing by to dethrone each other, watching you and watching me. Paranoid, the lens is our weapon, desensitized in our lust for attention, democratized by our voyeur obsessions, watching you and watching me. Slips to perfection, don't let them project you as you are. To make headlines, be immortalized. Everyone's got an electric eye, we're the digital spies. They've watched you for so long. Stay in line, don't make a mistake. We're watching.
We watched you for so long. We wait for you to fall. We will expose you all. I know you're out there somewhere watching me.
Experience begin right now. From high atop the mountains of British Columbia to you listening around the world, this is Spaced Out Radio. You can follow us on our website, spacedoutradio.com, on Twitter, at Spaced Out Radio. Give our Facebook page a like, Spaced Out Radio Show. You can follow us on Instagram, Dave Scott, S-O-R, or on our YouTube channel, Spaced Out Radio Show. Buckle up, space travelers. It's time to go for a ride as we are live on Spaced Out Radio. Good evening and welcome to Spaced Out Radio tonight. I am your host, Dave Scott, and thank you so much for tuning in to us at spacedoutradio.com and on Spreaker. As we come in from the frozen Canadian tundra, battle our way past the wild animals, sidestep Bigfoot, and enter Uncle Jimbo's cabin, stoke the fire, heat this place up, and broadcast you live on this Tuesday night, early Wednesday morning if you're on the East Coast. Here at Spaced Out Radio, we do this thing 3 hours a night, 7 days a week. We want to be your official one-stop shop when it comes to the paranormal, ufological, extraterrestrial, supernatural, and so much more. Spaced Out Radio's theme music is provided to us by guitar god Ron Bumblefoot Thal. You can find his album, Little Brother Is Watching, by going to our website, spacedoutradio.com, and clicking on the Bumblefoot banner. If you're on social media and on Twitter, give us a follow at Spaced Out Radio. Give our Facebook page a like, Spaced Out Radio Show. On Instagram, I can be followed at Dave Scott, S-O-R. Subscribe to our YouTube channel, Spaced Out Radio Show. And of course, our website is spacedoutradio.com. At this time, we want to send a shout out to those listening in the SHR Media Network, in Spaced Out Radio's chat room on Spreaker, and of course, our SOR Space Travelers on Facebook, Euphoria Chronicles on Facebook, and Paranormal Forum. If you're a fan of Spaced Out Radio, coming soon to our website, for only $5 a month, is the Space Travelers membership. We got a whole line of prizes, group interviews, special section on our website getting lined up as we speak. Hey, we're going to give you a heck of a lot more than just access to our archives. Tonight's show is brought to you by Rivulet Reiki and Readings, providing healings in person or at a distance. The official newspaper of this show is the New Agora newspaper. Spirit Story Box, the iPhone app, is the official ghost hunting app of Spaced Out Radio, and PurplePlates.com, helping heal your body, mind, and soul. Recently, I have been receiving a little bit of criticism on social media about this show, and in particular, myself and my so-called experiences. Some people saying that my stories aren't real, and I'm just making things up for publicity and airtime filler, that my stories aren't genuine, or just a little too out there. But the one thing I can say is, to defend myself, the majority of the experiences I have had personally have all had witnesses, including tonight's guest. You see, as our loyal listeners have heard me say over the days and months, I am still quite perplexed as to why many of these things have happened to me, like extraterrestrial encounters, UFO sightings, and being within dozens of feet of two Bigfoot. Samantha Mowat, I'm glad to not only call a talented psychic medium, but a mentor and a friend. Although I am much older than her, much, much older, I am looking up to her. Her stoic poise and dignity when it comes to her experiences and knowledge of extraterrestrials and encounters and contact is phenomenal. She literally lives it every day of her life. Now, the last time we had Samantha on, our audio wasn't too good because, well, my computer was on the verge of crashing. Samantha, though, is going to be a monthly contributor to this show with her segment called The ET Experience. That'll happen the second Tuesday of every month. And tonight, we will share what we saw together in the forests of British Columbia in April of 2014. We bring in Samantha Mowat. Her website, samanthamowat.ca. Samantha, thank you so much for being with us. How are you?
Hi, Dave. Thank you so much for having me on. I'm doing amazing. I'm so excited to be back and excited to get to retell this story with you.
Well, you know what? It is exciting, and I apologize to our listeners who didn't get the opportunity to do so last time because of the audio issues that we were having. And, well, we've kind of cured that with a whole new computer system that is running this show. But the one thing that I really like about you, Samantha, and I know you personally, I've known you way longer than I've had Spaced Out Radio going, is how genuine you are. And I'm really trying to push that on our audience a little bit here, because they got to get to know you. You have to get to know them. And the one thing that I want to say about our audience is they will be popping in with questions. They will be popping in with intellectual conversation. They are so smart, and they will be coming in wondering what the heck is going on and asking some great questions, whether they're in the Spaced Out Radio chat room on Spreaker, SORs, Space Travelers, Euphoria Chronicles, or Paranormal Forum. We really appreciate their time as well. And as we get them to get to know you, let's learn a little bit about you, because unfortunately, due to the last show, we're going to have to rehash all of it because literally the last show was butchered. So let's talk about you for a little bit here. As we introduce you to our audience, you're someone who literally was having extraterrestrial contact almost from birth.
Yes, I am. Well, Dave, to give you an idea of what my ET contact and multidimensional contact is like, and I need to emphasize that's not just extraterrestrials. It is also to do with multidimensional beings, because a lot of these beings, yes, they can come from different worlds, but many are able to travel between one vibrational frequency into the next, or as we know them, dimensions. In 2014 alone, I'm looking at my file for that, and I've got 28 pages on size 11 font, just recording what it is I had encountered that year. Yes, I've been a contactee since birth, and I have the good fortune of knowing where my soul origin is. My soul is from the Pleiades, although originally Lyra, and although I've had various extraterrestrial lives, I've been very fortunate having many of the beings that I've had previous incarnations with helping me during this lifetime to help bring forward some really interesting information. What they've told me it is that I'm intended to do is to take things such as psychic abilities and understanding energy, and I don't mean that as in the turn on a light bulb kind of way. I mean helping people understand their gut feelings, their dreams that they have, not dream interpretation so much as understanding how to astral project, lucid dream, things of that nature, and how they relate to the multidimensional universe that we live in. How's that for a minor introduction?
Well, I think it's great. But for a lot of people, as they get to know you, they're going to say, you've had ET contact with birth? That's impossible to know. How did you find out about that?
Well, I've had two things going on with that. The first one is when I was a very, very small child, I often felt and noticed presences moving around my room. I don't know about you, but you know when you see a partially invisible entity and it's walking around your room and you can tell, okay, you've cloaked your energy because you're trying to be considerate of me. That way I don't get either scared or feel uncomfortable going to sleep. How I found out about my first encounter was Johnny Enoch from Metaphysical Source was kind enough to give me this regression. Now, typically, regressions don't work very well on me at all. And quite frankly, it was amazing because although I was fairly conscious while it was occurring, he was helping to bring back memories without suggesting by any means when it was that my encounters had started. And what had happened for me was when I was a very small child, I was born in the 80s, and like most people in the 80s, my parents were smokers and they smoked in the house and they didn't really understand the dangers that it involved for infants. So my body was not happy with this. My twin brother, Danny, who has decided not to incarnate, which is quite all right. Earth is not for everyone. He decided that he wouldn't be born. And as a result, my soul felt betrayed, abandoned, angry, and quite sick, living in a household where there was so much grief over losing one of their first children. For my mother, she had twins as her first children, and to have only one child survive is a traumatizing thing. What I was able to see was my mother being downstairs, sitting on the couch, smoking a cigarette, just crying, looking completely lost and depressed. And then what happened was I was shown with my astral body where my little physical body was, this tiny little red-haired baby with fluffs of orangey red hair, laying on a bed, screaming so loud. And my mother had placed a pillow on either side of me, that way I couldn't roll. Although, by the look of it, I was only a couple weeks or maybe a month old, so I couldn't have rolled either way, but she was being cautious. And the next thing that I was shown was this beautiful tan extraterrestrial. Now, if you don't know what the tans look like, they are very similar in one sense to the grays, as in they do share characteristics of the upside-down, egg-shaped head with the larger black eyes, but unlike the grays, well, some varieties of grays, please excuse me, I'm getting interrupted with that, they are very loving and kind. They are very energy conscious. They are healers by nature and very much so looking out to help those that are, well, attempting to help people. This tan being had walked up to me very gently, and as it was walking up to me, it takes its, sorry, one second, I'm looking at my fingers, its pointer finger, and it places it very gently at about my xiphoid process, which is the center of your chest. And as it's placing a finger on my chest, it was singing to me in this alien dialect. It wasn't singing with its mouth. It was singing using telepathy because it's carrying the sounds, the vibrations, the same feeling that you would hear with singing, but you're hearing it in your mind rather than with your ears. And this is what's known as clairaudience. Now, this being looked partially invisible to me, meaning it wasn't there in its full flesh, but it was there within its energetic form. And as this being was sending this energetic healing into my body, the pain from the cigarette smoke on my newborn lungs was dissipating. And it began to feel alleviated, and I felt happier because I had someone who was familiar to me, someone that I felt safe near, which was this being. I didn't know my mother, I didn't know her energy, and I had agreed to incarnate with my brother, so he helped tell me that it was going to be okay and that I would understand with time. That is when my contact started.
When you look back at it and you mm-hmm. think of yourself growing up, yeah. I believe on Vancouver Island in British Columbia, and you started noticing things moving around and you started developing mm-hmm. your own intuitive abilities. When did the ET contact that you can remember from the top of your head rather than through a regression start for mm-hmm. you?
I would say it was 5 and in Nova Scotia. When I was living in Nova Scotia, well, my parents were in the military, so I did move for a good chunk of my very early childhood. We were getting close to moving, and I remember laying in my bed at night because my sister and I had two little single beds in one bedroom, and I remember seeing these beings that, which I didn't know at the time, were tans, kind of like they peek at the window and then they disappear. And I didn't think anything of it when I was little. I thought, okay, well, that's odd. But the next one that I can remember is seeing my brother Danny, and he was around quite a fair bit. I remember sitting one time in the sunshine as the movers were packing up the PMQ, which was a military-type housing that my family had lived in, and we're loading everything into the truck, that I was sitting under an umbrella, and I remember thinking, what's going on? Where are we going? And he had told me that he wouldn't be moving with me, that I wouldn't see him for a while, and I was very upset by this because he looked like a boy, but he did not look like a normal boy. If I had been aware at the time that they often use it's almost like a form of perception. One second. What am I trying to say, guys? They determine the level that you're most comfortable with perceiving them, and they can alter how you view them. That way, you're feeling comfortable. even though Danny is this white being with very blue eyes, I remember having a quite pale boy with blue eyes sitting under this umbrella with me. That was how it had changed.
Mm-hmm. Is this something that you regret happening? Do you feel that you were forced into it, or has it always felt natural to have ET contact?
I do not regret it by any means, but I did not always find it to be a wonderful thing. The main reason why at some points in my life I found it to be a little challenging is when I was a teenager and my mother was living on a 40-acre farm in the middle of nowhere, and I would go up there on the weekends. It was not very comfortable for me to feel various ETs outside, feeling someone watching you around the windows at night when you're home alone. Although I realized they were trying to be respectful and not invading my space, that they were just being there while protecting, loving, guiding, I wasn't happy that I could feel them. So like many people who are contactees, abductees, experiencers, you try drinking to escape what you're feeling, escape your encounters. It doesn't work, but that's okay.
Samantha, when you started accepting this, that this was going to be a part of your life, did you ever feel any different? Did you feel like an outcast when you were going through school, through high school, where, you know, perception is everything, bullying is everything, and being different is not the rule of the day during that time?
I felt like an incredible outcast, Dave, for most of my life. Especially when I was in high school, I tried doing the whole cheerleading thing, playing field hockey, student council, anywhere to try to have a better understanding of where I could fit in. I would go through group after group trying to see where I stood in the society, but I couldn't find out where it was. I even tried being a punk, if you can imagine that. Probably not with how you see me, but really, Dave, it's a very difficult thing to go through when you are having these encounters and you don't have anyone you can talk to. After one encounter, I did try to talk to my mother about it, and she just kind of dismissed it, saying, well, that's fine. The farm has a lot of encounters. She didn't mention anything beyond that. She said, well, sometimes you'll lay in bed and you'll feel ETs or you'll see ETs. But who can you tell when you're a teenager? If you tell your best friends, not only are you going to be ostracized, you're going to be bullied worse than ever. So sometimes you have to silently suffer until you actually learn what it is you're going through.
We are with Samantha Mowat tonight on Spaced Out Radio. Her website is samanthamowat.ca if you want to check it out. If you want a reading, you want to talk ETs, she's easy to get a hold of. Samantha, one of the things that I noticed in regards to ET contact, as you mentioned, when you're trying to figure out who you can talk to about this, even as adults, I know when I was, you know, starting to open up to people and say, this is what's happening to me, this is what I'm feeling, this is what I'm going through, it was difficult, especially when I approached my own parents about this. Mm-hmm. I can just imagine what it's like being a teenager, 15, 16 years old, as difficult as that is as a young woman at that time, or budding into a young woman, trying to figure out or tell your friends that, by the way, you're not from here. By the way, I see extraterrestrials and UFOs all the time.
Well, Dave, whenever I did try to tell people, it was normally after I had a few drinks and they assumed it was just being drunk. But that was the only time I had the courage to talk to anyone about it.
How do you feel about that now, though? Do you feel any different now that you're a grown woman? You have a family of your own, which that's about as far as I'm going to go on that topic. But on the flip side, you know, you have a lot at stake here as an adult, as most of us do.
Actually, Dave, I feel completely comfortable with it. I can go to a PAC meeting and all the ladies at my PAC, our school and what have you, know what I do. They're aware that I work as a clairvoyant psychic and that I'm working with extraterrestrials and multidimensionals. And for the most part, I don't have the same negative encounters with people that most people have. I find that because I've asked my guides, could you please keep people who can't handle this away from me, because I don't want to deal with it. And I've been very fortunate in that manner. I'm sorry, You had asked me something else as well, and I only answered part of that. What was the other question?
Oh, I'm trying to figure out what's going on in the chat room here. So I do want to ask you this, though. Mm-hmm. You talk very formal, very to the point with this type of topic. For a lot of people, that catches them a little bit off guard because it doesn't sound very natural. But you're so used to this, and this is how they have helped form you in this incarnation. Do you feel different, or that everything is just not what society would expect?
To an extent, yes, I do feel different. But when I was a small child in elementary school, I was very polite. I spoke to all adults, referring to them as Mr. or Mrs. I naturally apologized for things probably more than I should have. I was a very, very polite person, and it wasn't until I became a young adult that I really tried to get rid of that, because I found that I was being taken advantage of or misinterpreted. Yes, the ETs are the reason that I do speak this way, because I've had a lot of encounter with them. They do joke. Quite a few of them are very, very funny, but the way in which they present themselves is quite different from everyone else. They don't have the same understanding of slang that we do. They don't have the same vocabulary. You must remember that when it comes to their speech, they are aware of the energetic vibration behind what they're saying, and they are aware of the impact they wish to have upon you. As you know, everything is energy. Words carry a vibration which changes the way in which we perceive them. Just like how when you speak, your tone says a lot. For them, if you do say the wrong thing, you can be very, very offensive to someone. And for the majority, offending is not the intention. They're hoping to open up lines of communication, not shut them down.
Samantha, a lot of people who have extraterrestrial experience, and I was talking to a gentleman named James Borg last night from Euphoria Chronicles, mm-hmm. and his activity started much like mine did, and I've met a few people who've started like this, where everything seems to start with paranormal activity, and then as the vibration picks up, as the energy picks up, it shifts into extraterrestrials. Did mm-hmm. that happen for you as well, or was it strictly ET right along from the beginning?
No, mine has had a lot of paranormal stuff going on. I find they're very highly interrelated. What I believe is, this is an area that the two communities actually have to merge together, because they'll find a lot of paranormal activity is actually caused by extraterrestrials and multidimensionals as they're going between vibrations. But because you do have some of the multidimensional beings, such as your ghosts and deceased loved ones, things of that nature, they can produce a lot of the paranormal. And yes, they do raise your vibration, in the sense that they raise your vibrational awareness field. Like, let's say you go from the average person being a 3, encountering a ghost and knowing that you saw it and being aware that you've encountered that, or Bigfoot, will raise it to like a 4 rather than being a 3. So it kind of opens up your ability to perceive. And as you open up your willingness to perceive and want to be like, oh, it was so cool that one time I saw a ghost, I'd love to see something else again, you're kind of allowing more things to come in, because your vibration is more open to it as well. But the same can be said if you are very afraid of something. You can also bring in more things because your vibration is so focused upon that.
When you look at everything that you've gone through over the mm-hmm. last portion of your life since the beginning, and I'm not going to tell you how old you are, or everyone how old you are, because...
That's fine. I don't care if you do, Dave.
I don't even know. Last time I saw you, I knew you were 28, so that's all that I'm going to go with. But I think it's been a couple of years since then. But anyways,
I'm 29, but that's okay.
29. You know, about to enter a new decade here. Good for you.
I'm so excited.
Well, you know what? I'm not. I'm going to be 43 in 2 weeks from tonight.
Oh, happy birthday.
Well, thank you. And you can come on that night if you want, because I'm kind of opening up the lines to absolutely everybody. We're going to have a birthday party that's live on here, and we're going to talk about all sorts of stuff. So you're more than welcome to join us.
I certainly will.
But one of the things that I love and adore about you, and I mean that out of all due respect, is the fact of how blunt and easy the answers come to you when you ask yourself or ask for a question. A lot of people do not know how to get in touch with their guides. They don't know how to communicate with them because life happens. Mm-hmm. How were you able to stay in touch with your guides on a strict basis that you are on in order to get the information you need?
It is by no means a strict basis. Dave, one thing that people should be aware of is once you start opening that line of communication with your guides, which, by the way, we all have open when we're very small children, we communicate quite naturally from the time we were born until an average somewhere between 5 and 10, when generally people tend to decrease and eventually shut it off. If you do start opening up to them, and you can either use oracle cards or crystals like a pendulum, such as what you have. You can use all sorts of devices to start learning to connect with them, or you can just go straight on an energetic level, which is automatic writing or developing your clairvoyance. For me, if I'm not listening to my guides, I can't actually shut them out. I've tried. What I find that if you're having a lot of synchronicity in your life, that is your guides trying to communicate with you. Like, let's say you're looking at your clock on your cell phone or on your stove or on the computer, and you're seeing numbers like 111 or 333 or 1414. Those are synchronistic events. Chances are your guides are trying to remind you either of their presence and to look up the number meaning, or if you have a song that's stuck in your head. Dave, what's your favorite song?
Well, everybody knows. Paradise City, Guns N' Roses.
Perfect. Do you have one lyric in that song that gets stuck in your head all the time?
It is actually not a lyric. It's the guitar solo that leads to the whistle being blown about a minute 31 into the song.
Wow. Well, for people that have a certain lyric or, let's say, paragraph of the song that's stuck in their head, I want for them to go look that up. Find out what are the words to that section of the song. What is the meaning behind it? Because chances are, it's the answer to something that's going on in their life. And if they stop for a minute and actually think about it, they'll be like, oh, that makes sense. Thanks, guides. And as soon as you start acknowledging them, showing them, hey, I am listening to you. You don't have to say it out loud, because if a lot of people are concerned about looking schizophrenic. I communicate most of my guides in my head. Sometimes, which it can be very frustrating because they'll communicate just as quickly back and they'll think it's someone around me speaking when really it's them, and I'll reply out loud and I feel kind of silly, but that's okay.
Samantha, I'm going to get you to hold on here. We are going to hop out for our first break of the night. Tonight on Spaced Out Radio, we are talking with Samantha Mowat. She is an ET contactee. This is her first show as part of the ET Experience, our new monthly contribution to Spaced Out Radio. She'll be by on the second Tuesday of every month. Samantha's website is samanthamowat.ca. You can check that out as well during the break. You're listening to Spaced Out Radio. I am your host, Dave Scott. We'll be right back.
Would you like to become one of our space travelers? All you have to do is click on the space travelers icon at spacedoutradio.com. For only $5 a month, you can get access to some great prizes, as well as private monthly shows, newsletters, and a members-only section on our website. Become a space traveler today.
Hi there. This is your medium, Joanna, from Spaced Out Weekend, Two Mediums and a Large. I would love it if you would come and join us with host James Tyson every other Sunday on Spaced Out Weekend. Together, we will take your calls and your questions live. Our goal is to provide you with a positive outlook on deep questions that you may have. Questions regarding love, relationships, money, or whatever else is on your mind. Come and check us out at spacedoutradio.com.
Every Saturday and Sunday night, as Dave Scott wanders aimlessly in the wilderness, you can come hang out with me, James Tyson, in Spaced Out Weekend. Starting at 9 p.m. Pacific, midnight Eastern, I'll take you along as we talk with some of the best experts in their fields. SpacedOutRadio.com is the place to find us. So sit down, relax, put your feet up. Enjoy the topics like the paranormal, supernatural, intuitiveness, and so much more. Hope to see you there.
Hi there, this is Elizabeth Anglin, and on the last Monday of every month, I join Dave Scott for Spaced Out Radio's Cosmic Passport. We delve into everything from extraterrestrial contact to animal communication. It's a lot of fun, and every month it's something different and exciting. I would love it if you would join us. You can hear and learn from my experiences, and I'd like to know about yours as well. Cosmic Passport on spacedoutradio.com.
Hey everybody, this is Patrick Webster Small, and I'm here to bring you the Webster Phenomena every Saturday night, live at 8 p.m. Pacific, 11 p.m. Eastern. If you're looking for aliens and extraterrestrials, well, we've got them. Big and tall, short and small, you're bound to find what you're looking for. So join me on the Webster Phenomena, right here on Spaced Out Radio.
Visit purpleplates.com today. For over 40 years, the Purple Energy Plates have been delivering amazing results for their many customers. Inspired by the great genius Nikola Tesla, the harmony, healing, and energetic effects of the plates have proven over and over to be beneficial and often miraculous to thousands of customers. With their money-back guarantee and the many benefits, how can you afford not to get one? Check their site for daily specials and choose from their many energy products. You won't be sorry. Visit them today at purpleplates.com for mind, body, and spirit. And expect a miracle.
Have you ever wondered about those weird and strange creatures people have reported throughout history? Do you wonder if those stories are real? Me too, and that's why I started Cryptopia.us. Hey, this is Rob Morphy, crypto historian. Join me once a month on Spaced Out Radio with Dave Scott, where we will get into the odd and bizarre reports, from the Dover demon to hairy hominids and everything in between. I will break down what people like you and me are seeing at spacedoutradio.com.
Looking for a place to advertise at a very reasonable cost?
Look no further than Spaced Out Radio.
SpacedOutRadio.com has an advertising tab that you can click on to check out our daily, weekly, and monthly packages to play on radio
or our website, including social media.
From commercial spots to banners, we have it all.
Check out our competitive pricing today.
Want to connect with us online? Find us on Facebook, Spaced Out Radio Show, on Twitter, at Spaced Out Radio, on Instagram, Dave Scott, S-O-R, on YouTube, Spaced Out Radio Show, and our website is spacedoutradio.com. All right, space travelers, here comes the second half hour of Spaced Out Radio.
Welcome back to the second half hour of Spaced Out Radio tonight. I am your host, Dave Scott. Always a pleasure to have you on with us. If you are following us on the SHR Media Network, Spaced Out Radio's chat room on Spreaker, SOR Space Travelers, Paranormal Forum, or Euphoria Chronicles, thank you for being with us. We really appreciate you joining in the show and enjoying what we are broadcasting on a nightly basis. Remember, you can follow us on Twitter at Spaced Out Radio. Give our Facebook page a like, Spaced Out Radio Show. On Instagram, I can be followed at Dave Scott, S-O-R. Our YouTube channel, where we hide our archives, is Spaced Out Radio Show. And, of course, our website is spacedoutradio.com. Tomorrow night on the show, we are stepping back into the crypto world, talking werewolves and Dogman, the crypto guru. Ronald Murphy will be back with us tomorrow night. Tonight we are talking with the ET Connection with Samantha Mowat. It is our newest monthly segment that we do on Spaced Out Radio. Samantha's website is samanthamowat.ca. Samantha, welcome back.
Hi, Dave.
Couple questions from Claudia in the SOR Space Travelers room to kick off this half hour. Mm-hmm. The first one is, Samantha, what do you believe your mission is? Have the extraterrestrials given you a mission to complete here on Earth?
Oh, it's so funny you say that, Claudia. Yes, they have. The reason I say it's funny is you're actually, I think, the third or fourth person who's asked me that in the last couple days. My mission, or what I've been told I'm expected to do, is help to show the correlation between the development of your psychic abilities, which is ultimately your ability to perceive energy, manipulate energy, and understand how energy works around us, and the relationship that shares with contacting beings of other dimensions in order to help us when not only we do have them more involved in our lives, as you know, disclosure is coming, but for when the frequencies begin to further integrate, people will be relying more upon their telepathy and their psychic abilities to share information with these beings as well as receive information. In order for them to do that peacefully, they must learn to develop their abilities, and that is part of what I'm here to do. My other mission, which was one that I agreed to a bit later within this incarnation, was for the beings that are currently being misunderstood or misrepresented, I've agreed to help put them back in a more accurate light based upon who they truly are and not based upon the current media perception of which they're being represented as. For instance, not all greys are bad, not all reptilians are bad, not all Pleiadians are good. That is part of what I'm here to do.
Couple more questions from Claudia in the SOR Space Travelers room. Samantha, do you travel with your extraterrestrials in your dreams also, or just in the awakening state? Have you ever visited other planets?
Yes, Claudia, I do astral project with them quite a bit, as well as doing astral travel with them. And I have been taken quite a few times in my physical body. I'm sorry, what was the second part?
The second part was it just in dreams or in an awakening state? And have you visited other planets?
Yes, I have. I have been shown the Pleiades quite a few times, and I have been taken to Mars once by Coneheads, which I know that sounds very crazy. I promise I will be doing an entire segment on Coneheads. I was very surprised to meet them as well.
And the third question from Claudia in the SOR Space Travelers room is, Samantha, have you ever experienced being paralyzed by extraterrestrials when you were little, and does it still happen sometimes today?
No, I have never, to the best of my knowledge, experienced being paralyzed by extraterrestrials, not kind ones or not so kind ones, to the best of my knowledge.
Has all your contact been of the benevolent nature?
No, undoubtedly no.
When did you start having negative contact?
My negative contact actually started right before you and I were at Countdown to Contact, 2 days before. 1 second, pardon me, I need to cough. Thank you. My only negative encounters have been with about three different types, one variety of mantid, greys, and reptilians. Sorry, throat chakra imbalance, pardon me again. Okay, that's weird. I have had...
Quiet.
Thank you. I have had a few experiences that were bad. One in particular that happened in Hawaii. But for the most part, I've been very fortunate and have had mostly benevolent. If you are having malevolent experiences and you're looking for help, please feel free to email me at samanthamoad@live.ca. Or pardon me, smanthamode@live.com, and I will gladly help you deal with this. I deal a lot with energetic protection and ways in which you can protect your physical body by raising your vibration out of a field they can access, as well as raising your body, your energetic body, which is your soul vibration. That way they cannot attack you when you're sleeping.
Eugene has a question in the SOR chat room on Spreaker. Samantha, if you ever emerged with an extraterrestrial, or pardon me, if you've ever merged with an extraterrestrial, how was it accomplished?
I'm sorry, I don't know what merged is. Eugene, what do you mean?
I believe he means that you joined as one. Merged?
No, I do not believe I've merged into one or had one merge into me. I've seen myself in an extraterrestrial body, but that is something completely different.
What? Well, that opens up a whole new question here. How did you look when you were in an extraterrestrial form?
Well, Dave, you've seen what Danny looks like with very, very pale, milky white skin, very large blue eyes. Although you saw red with Danny, that's fine. Mine were very blue. I had no hair, quite long fingertips. That would place me just short of 6 feet tall. Just a form of Arcturian. When I've seen him on the other side, quite often I have switched over to that side. In one of my encounters, I don't want to go into the full length of it right now, but I can later if you wish. I was taken up on craft, and this was I don't like calling them dream encounters. It was an astral encounter. That's a more accurate way of putting it. As they took me out of my vehicle and brought me up on the craft, I was with about a dozen other people that were collected from the lower mainland over towards the Okanagan. And as we went on that craft, our bodies changed from being in our current state, which is in human bodies, over towards being in tan bodies. And the first thing I remember saying out loud in a telepathic message to the group was, Oh, that feels so much better. I forgot how uncomfortable that kind of body is. Just Claudia, encounters along that nature. Yes.
Claudia has another interesting question for you in the SOR Space Travelers Club on Facebook.
Mm-hmm.
Samantha, when you were speaking, are the extraterrestrials listening to you most of the time? Have they ever corrected you if your information was incorrect?
Yes and yes. They correct me, my guides correct me, so my deceased loved ones correct me. There is no shortage for them being willing to tell you if you're inaccurate about something, and I'm happy for that. I think it's wonderful being in contact with them. I want everyone to have this level of connection with their guides, with the beings they work with all those around them. It makes life more entertaining and happier and easier. It's wonderful.
Have you ever learned any other ET languages, and can you speak them now?
No, I can't speak them. I do not have the vocal capabilities in which to speak many of them. Most ET languages that I have encountered have been based upon telepathy, so even doing telepathy on here wouldn't make much sense because you can't hear it with your physical ears. And no, I don't know how to write them, although I could ask them through channeling to show me, or the next time I see them in person, I could ask them to write something down.
Bill in the SOR Space Travelers Club on Facebook is asking, do you ever get tired of having this kind of contact going on all the time? How do you rest?
Well, you got to remember, Bill, it can be a little bit annoying sometimes. For instance, one time I was actually at my dad's house and one of my children was having a horrible tantrum after a friend of mine had left, and I saw coming down from outside, pardon me, let me just retract to give you some further information. I was standing at the top of the stairs at my dad's house, and off towards the left is the kitchen, and there's the kitchen window. And out of the corner of my eye, I can see from the kitchen window this gold energy orb type light coming down from what felt like a craft up top down onto the walkway. And I remember as soon as I saw it, I was like, not right now, as loud as I could, telepathy. And I felt the energy going right back up because they knew, yep, she is not in the mood to see us right now. Now is not a good time. For the most part, they can be very respectful. I know it may sound odd to some of you hearing someone being willing to deny encounters, but when you have them this frequently, it's fine. They know, okay, I can't see right now. I will try again tonight, either astrally, or I will try tomorrow, or I will try the next time that's working for both parties.
I want to get into how you and I really came together.
Okay.
All right. Because in my introduction, as you heard, the past couple of weeks on social media, I've been having a lot of pot shots thrown at me in regards to whether or not my experiences are real, whether if not I'm just a storyteller. The people who listen to this show and the regulars know that I have no reason to BS anything. And the reason why I started this show, as I've stated many and many a time, is because, like the people out there, I'm looking for answers as to why this happened to me on a personal level. And I'm not trying to be selfish about it or say this show is about me, because in the end it's about the listeners and it's about the people trying to get answers from our guests, such as yourself. But with every thing that's positive, there has to be a negative that follows. It's the yin and yang. In April of 2014, around April 10th, we were at a friend's property. You were not there. I hadn't even met you yet. And I was summoned to come outside and look into the back field for a UFO. And when I got outside and I asked it where it was out of God's peace, love, and light, it turned on its lights. And it did that three times for me. I met you 5 days later. And from that point on, I'm going to be honest with you, I didn't expect, as much as I knew it was going to happen, I sure as hell didn't expect to be walking with a stranger, which you were at that time, and walking into a forest to see an extraterrestrial. What do you remember about that day when we first met?
Well, Dave, you had arrived there before me, because as I was driving to our friend's house for my second visit. I only had met that woman once before that. I could feel the vibration of craft somewhere over the forest that was... what's the name of that? Oh, never mind. Don't even tell me the name of the road. Along that road that she lived on, as I was driving from my house out of town, out towards her house, and it felt like it was really alive and pulsing. And honestly, Dave, I didn't really think much of it when I was feeling craft. I just assumed I'd be visited that night, because it is quite normal to feel craft during the day when they're going to be coming to see you later. Then when I got there, I went inside, and I remember being introduced to you and your wife quite quickly. And it was interesting because she had mentioned you previously. Sorry, context. The friend of ours had mentioned you previously, and she had said that you were someone who could call ships. And I remember saying to her, wow, I would love to meet someone who could do that. I don't know how to do that. That's amazing. Maybe they can teach me. Because let's face it, we all know different parts of the puzzle, and it's so wonderful to put them all together and see how they coincide. And we were sitting in the living room. I think you were sitting right by a huge salt lamp. And we were there for about a half an hour when your head started buzzing. And I believe you said that was your way of feeling ET energy. And then you said something about being guided to go outside. And now, what was interesting... One second. What else happened, guys? Thank you. You said, I'm going to go outside. And then I said to you, do you mind if I come as well? And you looked at me and you're like, yes. But then you proceeded to point at the other people in the room and you're like, not you and not you. And you said, you've got to stay inside. And I thought that was kind of odd because I had never really encountered that before. But I assumed, why not? Let's just go for this. And then as you and I left the house, we had all four dogs with us. And three of them are quite big dogs. And of course, that really cute little small dog of yours. Now, as you and I walked around the house and through the back field and into the woods, I remember I wanted to walk along that ravine that was off towards the left between the road and the forest. And I really felt a strong pull to walk along the river and keep going deeper into the forest. But your energy kind of pulled back, Dave. Your aura was a little bit close to your body, and then you told me that going further that way was going to lead us into Sasquatch territory. And I remember hearing quite a few things about mission and Sasquatch, so seeing as I had never encountered them, I didn't want to go further into that area at that time. Now, in my being, I knew that I was safe to go that way, but because you and I were doing this activity together, I remember thinking, okay, if he's feeling apprehensive, then I don't want to expand upon that energy. And you and I turned back towards the house a bit, and then we stopped to look for where the energy was coming from, because it felt like it was all around us.
It sure did. And the one thing I remember before we went in the forest, I was showing you where the craft was 5 days previous to that.
Yes, you have.
And you were picking up on the energy because you were asking me questions. Okay, where did the light seem like it was emanating from? What did it look like? And then you started pointing, well, I'm picking it up over here. And I'm like, yes, that's where it was. And we walked parallel in our friend's yard to where it was when it landed 5 days previous. And then you said to me, and I'll never forget this, you said, I'm being pulled into the back forest. What do you think about going back there? And I remember taking this big sigh, and I said, yep, we can do that. And you said, okay, are you sure? Because the chances of us seeing something back there are very, very strong. And I said to you, I know. And you said, are you ready to see them? And I said, what the F? And I think you know, and then you followed up by saying, as we started walking towards the forest in behind the property, you stated, I'm not sure if they will be there, though, because of the dogs, because you pointed out the dogs and you made a comment that most extraterrestrials are not fans of dogs. And so what I recall from there was the dogs led the way into the forest. And as you and I started walking in, because you wanted to go to the Bigfoot territory.
I totally did.
And I was heading the other direction. So you wanted to go left. I wanted to go right. And we're at this crossroads of what to do. We turned around and looked. And all four dogs were gone.
I remember that because I had stepped on top of the stump because I wanted to get a better vantage and see where the heck the puppies had gone to. But I didn't hear them leave. I didn't see them leave. Did you hear them?
No, I didn't see a thing. All of a sudden,
we turned and looked, and the dogs were gone, and you said, oh, that's strange. And I went, yeah. And then we continued walking a little bit further towards the stump, where I remember you looking at me, and you said, and you looked at me, and you had this stern teacher-like look on your face, and or motherly type look. And you, I remember you said, Dave, I need you to look at me. I want you to look over there. You pointed north, and I don't want you to be afraid, but I want you to tell me what you see. And I remember I slowly turned to my left, and I looked, and there was the 10 to 12 foot being standing there about 200 feet away from us. And I remember saying, Samantha, what the F is that? What the F is that? And I must have repeated that about 20, 30 times. And
then the second being appeared, but it appeared right behind it, so you didn't notice it.
I did not see it.
But that's okay. You got to remember, Dave, the reason why I ended up seeing one, well, I saw two beings, and I saw them with more of their true nature, and you saw the one energetic form being, is because I'm approaching it from more of a comfortable, clairvoyant level. These are beings that I've encountered my entire life. And for you, this is your first encounter, and they want to approach us in a way in which you're more comfortable. Because let's face it, if you had seen a 10-foot-tall, tan extraterrestrial that looks similar to a gray, I'm not so sure how well you would handle that at that time. Now you'd be very excited, probably running over to go shake its hand or something, but then I don't know how well it would have necessarily went over.
Well, I can tell you now that if you and I ever had that experience again, we're going up there. We're going to say hello. And the one thing that has always stuck with me, Samantha, about this situation or this experience, and I've told it on this show dozens of times, when I've been a guest on someone else's show, I've always mentioned this, was how concerned these two beings, and I only saw the one, you saw the two, but how concerned these beings were for my health. Because we always, always see the negative in the extraterrestrial phenomena. Whether it's Hollywood, whether it's books, whether it's people exposing their stories in a public fashion, it always seems to be negative. It always leads to the quote unquote anal probing. It always
Never had that, so I don't know where that's coming from.
Well, that came from Whitley Strieber from his book Communion. And we always hear the negative. That's what I'm trying to say. Yet if they were negative entities, and this is what I have had troubles working around, if they were negative entities that we were seeing in the forest that day, and I want to preface this, it was 2 o'clock in the afternoon when this happened.
There was a beautiful sunny day.
Not a cloud in the sky. And when this happened, and I'm saying this with my eyes closed because I'm picturing this being right now, what I recall them saying to us was, you are more than welcome, because you were telepathically communicating with the second one.
Well, and, both of them, Dave. It's easy to communicate with them.
Well, I was a little bit shitting my pants, lack of a better terminology there. Okay. But what I'm saying is, they were inviting us over, but they were so concerned for my health and my well-being. I remember you saying, Dave, they've invited us to come over and say hello, but they are very concerned about your health and whether or not you will be able to handle it.
Well, Dave, they didn't want your heart to give out. Your heart was very excited.
And I want to say this. It's not that I was scared seeing them.
No.
But what it was, Samantha, and you know this because you were there. And but for the rest of my audience who hasn't heard this story, I want to say, where I was fearful was everything that I had learned in my 40 years of life up to that point was now on a piece of paper that was crumpled up and thrown in the garbage. Because I felt that everything I had been taught, everything that I had known as quote-unquote reality was now over.
Well, Dave, you've got to remember two things. One, I was standing there smiling. I wanted to go walk up these beings. I felt safe, and they were just as happy to see me as I was to see them, and they were excited to meet you. But these thoughts, feelings, and emotions that you were holding on to that were really coming to the surface at that moment for you, which made them apprehensive to have you come forward, is not necessarily something that is truly yours. But one thing I do recommend that all your... What I do recommend that your audience look into is there's an access consciousness. And what it is it teaches us about 98% of our thoughts, feelings, and emotions belonging to other people. And yet, because all of humanity is empathic, we are all clairsentient and energy sensitive, we pick up on these energies and these belief systems that aren't ours. We hold on to them as if they are ours. And as a result, we base our decision-making process upon things that aren't necessarily true for us. True for someone else, but not for us. And as a result, we tend to make decisions within a situation that we regret later or do not feel happy about. And what this actually teaches you to do, access consciousness, that is it teaches you to release, see different mentalities that you've held on to, series of like something, my throat chakra is right out of whack. One second, please, people. Thank you. What it teaches you to do is to return the energy that you had picked up, the belief system that you believed was yours, and return it to the person who truly owned it. Now, Dave, the reason why I'm bringing this up is, as you had mentioned, you had crumpled up on a piece of paper all the beliefs that you had learned from other people, and it was then affecting you within that moment, wasn't it?
Yeah, that's exactly it. It was mind-blowing, mind-altering, and it was a major shift in my life. A major shift. And I think today I have come to terms and come to grips with it. Mm-hmm. However, you know, it's funny, as I've come to grips with it, the experiences have pretty much died right down.
Well, that's okay, Dave. You got to remember, part of the reason why you may be going through a lull is you're either A, you might not be remembering them, which is fully possible, or you may have so much on your plate that they don't feel it's necessary at this time to come in and alter something.
Samantha, I'm going to get you to hold on here. We're going to continue this conversation about our extraterrestrial experience in April of 2014. Our guest tonight on Spaced Out Radio is Samantha Mowat. She is the newest contributor to the monthly show every second Tuesday of the month. Samantha will join us for the ET experience. We're introducing you to Samantha tonight. And your questions, more of this experience between Sam and myself, coming up right after this break. You're listening to Spaced Out Radio. I am your host, Dave Scott. We'll be right back.
Greetings and salutations, space travelers, from the Chronicles of the Unknown team.
What is Chronicles of the Unknown? I keep hearing about this thing.
It's a new paranormal reality TV show based right here in beautiful British Columbia, Canada. Follow our team as we uncover claims of activity on the Caribou Gold Rush Trail. You can also follow us here every third Monday, where two members of our team will be available to answer your questions. We'll give you some equipment updates and some of our experiences on the road, right here on Spaced Out Radio on the Spreaker.com network.
Do you believe you've been in contact with extraterrestrials? Have you seen the Greys, the Mantis, or the Reptilians? I am Samantha Mowat, and on the second Tuesday of each month, you can listen and learn from my experiences with off-worlders on Spaced Out Radio's The ET Experience. With host Dave Scott, we'll sit down and chat about what's going on with our friends from other worlds. We'll also try to answer your questions. So please, tune in on the second Tuesday of the month, only on Spaced Out Radio.
Are you interested in advertising on Spaced Out Radio? Head to our website, at spacedoutradio.com and click on our advertising tab. There, you will find an assortment of ways you can get your product out there with us, from radio commercials to banners and social media. Have a product you like our hosts to endorse? We can do that too. Visit spacedoutradio.com for more details.
Did you know that Spaced Out Radio runs 7 days a week? Hi, it's James Tyson from Spaced Out Weekend. Every Saturday and Sunday night, starting at 9 p.m. Pacific, midnight Eastern, you can join me and my guests for some great chatter about what's going on out in the universe, or even in that dark part of the basement you really don't want to go back into. Well, let's find the answers to your experiences together. So come on up to Uncle Jimbo's cabin on the weekend. For more information, look us up at spacedoutradio.com.
You hear footsteps in the empty room above you. A rocking chair begins rocking by itself. Don't be afraid of the things that go bump in the night. Reach for Spirit Story Box, the iPhone app the Huffington Post UK called the only ghost hunting app you will ever need. Spirit Story Box. The spirits are telling their stories. Are you listening?
Attention, Spaced Out Radio listeners. For only $5 a month, you can join Spaced Out Radio Space Travelers. Your membership at spacedoutradio.com will give you access to private fan area on the website, get you a monthly newsletter, draws for monthly swag, and a whole lot more. Sign up today to become a part of the Spaced Out Radio experience.
Right here, this is where we divulge the fruit of our research. Here on the Webster Phenomena every Saturday night at 8 p.m. Pacific, 11 p.m. Eastern, on Spaced Out Radio. And we give it up to you guys, all the listeners and the live listeners. You can get something special and hang out in the chat room, and we love to have you. So we'll see you every Saturday night at 8 p.m. You know where.
If you're a fan of social media, you can follow Spaced Out Radio on Twitter, at Spaced Out Radio. Give our Facebook page a like, Spaced Out Radio Show. You can also follow us on Instagram, Dave Scott, S-O-R. Our YouTube channel, where our archives are stored, is Spaced Out Radio Show. And of course, our website is spacedoutradio.com.
Welcome back to the second hour of Spaced Out Radio tonight. I am your host, Dave Scott. Thank you so much for tuning in. If you're on the SHR Media Network listening in the Spaced Out Radio chat room on Spreaker, or the SOR Space Travelers on Facebook, as well as Euphoria Chronicles and Paranormal Forum, thank you for joining us tonight. Tomorrow night on the show, we're talking werewolves and Dogman. The crypto guru, Ronald Murphy, will be with us to talk everything cryptid tomorrow night. If you want to follow us on Twitter, you can do so at Spaced Out Radio. Give our Facebook page a like, Spaced Out Radio Show. On Instagram, I can be followed at Dave Scott, S-O-R. Our YouTube channel is Spaced Out Radio Show. That's where we hide our archives. And our website is spacedoutradio.com. Tonight, we are talking with our newest contributor to a monthly show every second Tuesday. Samantha Mowat will join us for the ET Experience. Her website is samanthamowat.ca. Samantha, welcome back to Spaced Out Radio. Thank you for being with us. You're going to be with us for the full 3 hours tonight. Thank you for doing that.
Thank you for having me, Dave. It's lovely to be here.
Well, you know what? I think it's important, too, that our audience gets to know you and a little bit about you. And right before the break, we were talking about you and me and the experience that we had with the extraterrestrials in the forest at 2 o'clock in the afternoon around April 15th of 2014. Mm-hmm. Now, you did your best to try and calm me down. When you looked at me in that situation, what were you seeing? Because when I looked at you, I saw someone who was very calm, controlled, almost excited because we were having this groundbreaking contact in the middle of the afternoon, in the middle of a beautiful forest on a blue sky, not a cloud in the sky, and then there's me.
Well, Dave, when I looked at you, you're very good at hiding your emotions on your face. Believe it or not, you did not look panicked. You actually look like you're quite intense. You look like you're really thinking, but your energy was a little lopsided, going a few different directions. That was an indication that you were having your mind going, is this safe? Is this not safe? Is this something I want to do? Do I not want to do this? How do I feel right now? You're very analytical with your energy. So to me, I was just thinking, okay, let's just try to calm them down, see how this goes. It should be fun.
I'll tell you, that was one hell of a first date. I'm going to tell you that right now. You know, I mean that jokingly, as Mrs. Spaced Out Radio was about 500 yards behind us in a house. But the whole fact is, on a serious note, you know, this is natural to you. And I remember you saying, we can go over there. We're allowed to go say hello. But I was adamant that I wasn't getting into that. Then you started mentioning about free will. Where did free will come into play there?
Well, it's a free will universe. It's up to you. Whatever you decide is what is going to be determined. They wouldn't come over unless they knew both of us were feeling comfortable. And they wouldn't allow for you to come over if you didn't feel comfortable. If you started walking towards them and you were feeling nervous and were very uncomfortable with it, Dave, they would have just left. That is where free will comes from. They wanted you to know that it was entirely up to you what you chose to do, and that would determine what would happen.
What would have happened if we went over there?
We would have been very close to some extraterrestrials. We would have exchanged communication with them, most likely. Well, I know for me, telepathic, but for you, most likely telepathic as well. Chances are they either would have asked us if we wanted to join them on their ship. And I don't believe we'd actually really miss any time, because we're pretty good at changing and modifying time like that. Yet we still would have had an encounter with them.
Are you upset with me that we didn't go over there? I've never asked you that before.
No, not at all. I see Tams quite frequently. To me, it's fine.
Well, I got to be honest with you. I'm a little upset that we didn't. You know, looking back on it now, and I've said this many a times on this show and when I've been a guest on other shows, I would love to have that experience again with you. And the reason why is I feel, as much as I felt fulfilled because that was something that changed my life, I think, for the better, it still feels like there's something missing. It feels like, and I've been taken, I make no bones about that, I've been taken at night, but the rarity from what I hear on this show and from talking to other experts of having that encounter in the middle of the day, in the middle of broad daylight, when everything is conscious, everything is out in the open, it almost seems like I have a better chance of winning the lottery or finding a needle in a haystack than that situation happening again. And I'm really hoping, fingers crossed, four-leaf clover, Lucky Charms every morning for breakfast, that I'm not that I am wrong about that.
I think you are wrong. I say let's just go camping.
Well, it's easier for you to say that. You know, because I can't even call a UFO in the sky anymore like I used to be able to. And I'm frustrated with that, to be honest with you. But on the flip side, there is a tone of reality to this, because when we were there, going back into that forest, and I was starting to calm down, you started picking up extraterrestrial energy to the right of us about 100 yards.
Yeah, there was a whole bunch of them. They were all around the trees.
Yet when we
those two weren't the only ones there, Dave.
I understand that now, and I'm very happy to comprehend that. But when we walked into that area about 100 yards away to start looking for them, if the other two showed themselves to us, and I only saw the one, why were the other ones not showing themselves to us? Because I recall you not seeing any, I was not seeing any. And we went high, we went low, we went stood on stumps, rocks, whatever we could to get a higher vantage point in this forest, and we couldn't see them.
But Dave, what makes you think that all of them were there to see us? A lot of extraterrestrials are also collecting samples of the Earth around us. They want to know, okay, well, how have things changed in the last year, 10 years, 20 years, 50 years? What is the energy coming out of these plants? Okay, what is their life essence rate at this time? Because they are very connected. Almost all forms of grays, tans, tall whites, a lot of them are, well, not the tall whites, pardon me for saying that one, but they are very connected to plant type nature. and they're able to read the energetic signature coming out of it, and they get an idea of how that section of the Earth is doing. That could be a very simple reason why they weren't connecting with us, yet the two were. The other ones could have been doing something of more significance.
Well, see, the reason why I'm asking that is because I have always wondered, Samantha, when we went back to the original area where we saw the two, they were gone.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering, was that maybe an escape mechanism for them, so that way they couldn't they didn't have to show us how they left?
Dave, it doesn't really matter why, how it is they left. They could have left one of two ways. Their craft could have been either right there on the ground or in the sky, and they could have went back into it that way, or they could have simply teleported. We both know they're able to do that by opening up vortexes quite easily.
I'm still mystified by it.
It didn't feel like an escape mechanism. Why would they call us out there if it was an escape mechanism? They could have simply said, another time, you and I were the ones that turned to walk away from them. We finished the conversation. We didn't turn around continually to see what they were doing.
This is true. As stupid as it sounds, I think I was quite naive in believing that when we got back there, they would still be there, kind of waiting for us. I don't know, maybe biting their fingernails or something along those lines in regards to it. But I can honestly tell you that, and my listeners as well, I'm still a little miffed at myself. And I know I don't have to be, I shouldn't be, but knowing what I know now, I would have walked over there.
Okay, that's fair. But Dave, think of it this way. That was just your first significant encounter. Seeing as you've had an encounter like that, you're going to have more.
Well, the one thing when we came out of that forest, or when we started and we left the forest and we started walking back, the thing that always amazes me is we were greeted by the four dogs.
That, and what amazed me was the amount of plane activity above us.
Yes.
There was none when we went into the forest, but we were just simply bombarded afterwards.
It was an amazing roller coaster ride for that half an hour in my life that changed my life forever and eventually led to Spaced Out Radio. I still want to know where the dogs went, though. That's what I would like to know.
Well, it's simple energetic manipulation. You can either send an image into all four of the dogs' mind of, hey, let's go back at the house. Someone's calling us for food. The dogs go back to the house. No one's calling us for food. Oh, what's this smell? Oh, Dave and Samantha went this way. Let's go see them. And all four dogs happily prance back. ETs are well renowned for sending telepathic messages into someone's head or telepathic suggestions if they don't want to have people, animals, or other things around them.
I want to get to a couple of questions here from the SOR Space Travelers. Claudia is asking you, Samantha, instinctively, can you understand or read hieroglyphics? And have you been told why hieroglyphics are on ships?
No. I've actually never even thought to really look at hieroglyphics, Claudia, to tell you the truth. One thing that I am planning on doing is going to Egypt and seeing hieroglyphics, because I do feel it will unlock something in me. But no, even when I'm on craft, when you're there, you don't think to look at that. You don't think to read them. I'm sorry, but no, I don't know if I can.
All right. Claudia's next question is, what are the feelings or signs, Samantha, when the extraterrestrials are near you?
It depends on which group. Okay, let's take a few minutes and kind of break this down. I have what I refer to as my little brown guy. When my little brown guy is with me, and he is a very small brown ET, he's a variety of gray. He's more of like a sandy, browny tan color. He feels quite light. He feels quite playful. He has a higher vibration. He almost feels like a little kid when they're being mischievous and a little bit fun. So when he's coming near me, I often feel a sudden surge in the energy within a minute or so before I actually see him. Now, let's see, who else is there? If I'm having beings such as, let's say, I'm sorry to go here, but if I'm having any reptilian entities coming within my home, which up until I started implementing energetic protection every day, they were coming, I would feel, depending upon the intention of them, like let's say it was a positive reptilian, they may feel more, well, I'd see more of the invisible outline, as in being more aware, watching me, getting an idea of what's going on before actually seeing more of a 6 or 7 or 8 foot tall being in a corner watching. But the energy of the more benevolent ones felt more of a neutrality to them, almost like they were observing rather than actually feeling the heartfelt connection. When I've had more negative reptilian in my being, it felt very, almost like it was trying to place an intimidation tactic on me. I'm pretty sure you all have been bullied at one point in your life by one person who tries to use their size to dominate over you. That is the kind of energy in which that one black reptilian, that is, I've seen several times now, has had. Let's see here, who else should we talk about? Coneheads I've only encountered on the astral dreamscape. Ooh, light beings, thank you. When I've encountered more light beings, they feel very, oddly enough, wispy. They feel quite very, very high vibration. Almost feels like the air is tingling. It feels alive, almost staticky, but in a very calm, loving way. It's almost like the air is energized or charged, very similar to craft in one sense, but a little bit different. When I met Pia, my primary Reiki guide, who is a crystalline being on a much higher vibration, she's more of a multidimensional rather than an extraterrestrial, because she lives in more of a crystalline world. Her energy felt very grounded, yet so pure, almost like running water. How she looked was amazing. She didn't have individual hairs like what we did. She didn't have skin. Her body was pure, crystalline, absolutely beautiful. When I've met... One second. What other groups have we talked about here? Just trying to go over a list in my head. Thank you. When I've had mantis around, the mantis that tends to be near more of my family, she's actually quite nice. She has more... You know the energy that people that are nurses and doctors have, very caring, compassionate? Yes. That's more of what she possesses. And whenever anyone is sick in our household, I find that this being comes around a fair bit for healing. Now, what's interesting around her is she has more of like a tanny color to her. She's... Dave, you saw the drawing that I did?
Yes.
She's got... Her head is quite... How can I describe it? It's triangular in shape, definitely much heavier and fuller towards the back, and getting very narrow in the front. She's got these very large, beautiful eyes. One second. Very, very small shoulders, and her body, her spine's kind of interesting, so it's on more of an angle. I can, for the life of me, I do not remember ever what her legs look like, what her bottom half of her torso looks like. I can't remember if there are legs or if it's more of an insectoid type bottom. She's quite nice. I have some cat beings that are around me too. They feel more, well, they don't feel cat-like per se. They feel more regal, and I'm sorry, I don't have my list in front of me of everyone that I've ever encountered, but those are the ones I can think of offhand, Claudia. I hope that helps.
The other question Claudia has as a follow-up to this is it the same feeling, Samantha, when you are around ships or when you know ships are going to appear?
Depends on the group in which the ship is associated with. For instance, whenever I've felt more of, I know it's going to sound a little bit silly, but whenever I felt the town's group and their ship is quite different because it feels like it's got more of that pulsing sensation. But whenever I've seen the tan beings, they don't have that continuous energetic fluctuation that their ship has. Their ship feels more of almost like it's not breathing and alive, but almost like it's going through a rotation within the energy field, like it's continually renewing itself. I have no idea what ship the reptilians use. When I have seen the Coneheads, their energy was almost, they were excited. Think of people who are traveling to, let's say, Canada for the first time, and they're so excited to meet people, and they're just happy and very inquisitive, very attentive. That was more of their energy. But when I saw their ship felt almost like it was, well, my husband felt it, and I felt it, because we both felt it before I went to bed that night. It felt like it was just pouring down, like it was, how can I explain? Almost like a gentle breeze or gust coming. So, to answer it pretty simply, Claudia, it depends on the group that is coming that it'll really determine who it is vibration-wise for the ship. So that's my best way of guessing. Even sometimes I'll see a craft and I'll be like, wow, that's interesting, followed by my thought of, I have no idea which one that is.
Yes. Claudia also wants to know, and realistically, she should have her own show because she asks such brilliant commercial questions. Samantha, when you were off this planet and mm-hmm. taken, what yes. did you see or learn from where they took you?
Okay, which time? Okay, let's go with Seth. So what happened for me was it started out when I was in an astral encounter. I had astral projected out of my body, and I decided, hey, show me somewhere I've never been before. And the first place that came to mind was, oh, let's go to San Francisco, because I had never been to San Francisco, and I still haven't. So I astral projected myself to being there, and it was nighttime, and I was walking down the street, and as I'm walking down this very beautiful hilly street where there are bistros and all sorts of different kinds of restaurants and shops that were closed, I was walking and I saw these people, and they're looking at this guy. I'm like, oh, look, a UFO. And then I knew it's still like, hi, Coneheads, it's me, remember me. And of course, I'm sending the projection of when I had encountered them. And as I'm sending them this energetic projection, thank you, they end up pulling my energy up towards the ship, I do believe it was. And as I got there, I saw this one young man. Nope, sorry, pardon me, they're correcting me. Claudia, you're going to have to bear with me. I've got over 28 pages for 2014. Sometimes I mix up as to whether they came down or I got buzzed up. Picked up, thank you. So I had met this young Conehead, and his name was Seth. And as he and I were standing in front of each other, he's very tall. His head is probably about, like, let's say his face is about 6.5 feet up, and his cone goes on a slight angle, not straight up like the movie. That is not accurate, and they are certainly not 2 feet above their head. I would say it was more like 8 inches, maybe 12 inches at the very most. And as I'm looking at Seth, he has a young energy. I can feel that his body is actually quite older than me, but it feels as though, as far as, not as maturity, but within his culture, he felt like he was a younger one. He felt like he was in his mid-20s, according to their culture. Now, he walks up to me and he shakes my hand. I'm like, hi. And he's shaking very, very vigorously. And I'm like, I'm Samantha. He's like, I'm Seth. I'm like, oh, okay. And then he invites me on board his craft. Now, what was interesting about this is as I go into this black triangular craft, which, by the way, it was not a military craft. I know people say any black triangular craft is automatically military. Well, I beg to differ. And anyways, as we walk into there, it's definitely bigger on the inside, but it's really not huge. It's probably the size of your standard living room. This one was just a small transport vehicle. And as I go in there, off to one side, I see two young males who are similar age to Seth, and they're all wearing these black body outfits, and they do, oddly enough, have some form of minor cape on, but I don't know what the purpose of it was, but they were wearing it. And Seth walks me over to this seating section where there are two females, and as he requests that I sit down beside them, I try to engage in conversation with these two females, and neither one of them was very talkative, but on each wall, well, not really wall, that's definitely the wrong way to put it, but on where you would normally have your walls were these viewing screens. And on the viewing screens, we could see what was around us and what different information was. I looked at the language, but I didn't understand. It was something I've definitely never encountered before. And the next thing that I recall, Claudia, was they had taken me, and I was all of a sudden in this very large underground area. And I was a little bit confused because I'm looking around and I didn't recall how we got from the craft to this area, and I was just with Seth all of a sudden. And it almost felt like a busy airport terminal. But I'm looking around and I'm seeing dozens and dozens of different types of beings. And they're moving from one area to the next in all sorts of directions. And there didn't really seem to be any rhyme or reason for anything that was going on. And as I look at him, he pulled up out of the floor a hologram, and he is explaining to me about how they weren't able to use the surface of this. I'm like, well, where am I? Because I had no idea. He's like, oh, we're on Mars. I'm like, why am I on Mars? And then he was explaining some more information about that, but I don't recall at this time what it is he had said. But it was a very interesting hologram because he was able to pull it up, and it looked like it was probably 3 or so feet wide and probably a good 4 or 5 feet tall. It was quite interesting. The other times when I've been taken off, oh goodness, you're really making me think with this one. Let me think here, what was the other time? If you're watching the Countdown to Contact video, I end up talking about this one encounter where I awoke on my way to being, well, my physical body being taken out of my house, and I woke halfway down the hallway, and when I awoke, I knew that I had just either been put back from craft or I was about to be taken, but I went back to sleep either way. The next thing that I ended up calling from that was I was suddenly in a log cabin in the middle of the woods. Now, you may think, okay, this is kind of scary. And it wasn't so much the being in the woods that threw me off. It was more the fact of when I'm looking to my left, it was darker than I remembered it being when I had went to sleep. Now, 1 second. Show me more. Thank you. The walls were dark gray, and it looked like it was someone's hunting cabin. It was sparsely furnished. It was quite odd. And off to my left was this larger window. It looked like the window was divided in sections rather than just being a picture window. And as I'm standing there, I see this craft suddenly rising off the ground and quite close to the building, close enough that whoever had honestly placed the craft there, I do not think was very logical in their placement in proximity to the building. And I remember screaming because I was concerned all of a sudden because I didn't know why I was there or why this craft was leaving, and here I was by myself. Now, directly in front of me, I think it was 10 or 15 feet or so, was a door and the entryway to the cabin. And as I'm staring at this window and I'm yelling, this small white being comes in, and she is a variety of gray, and she was much smaller than me. I would say she's around 3, maybe 4 feet tall. And I felt safe near her, but when she looks at me, she was very annoyed by how loud I was being, so she instantly got my voice to stop. And then I'm a little bit silly when I see them sometimes, because I walked up to this being and I wanted to hug her. And 1 second, did I hug her, guys? Ah, right, I did hug her, thank you. And as I'm embracing this being, I'm like, oh, what is your name? And she didn't give me a name, to be honest with you. I feel as though she was a little bit surprised that I was conscious to the point I was. I don't think I was supposed to be that awake. So she had led me outside, and please bear with me, it's gonna be a couple minutes, but there's a lot of detail to this story, and I'll skip over part of the in-craft part. One thing that I want to express to you is as she had led me outside, there was snow outside. Now, I was living at Mission at the time. There was not snow where I lived. This is Vancouver. We get more rain than anything down there. And so I knew instantly, okay, I'm in the mountains and there's thick forest. And my feet were very, very cold. And telepathically, she sent me the message, do not worry. It won't be very long until they're warm again. And then I noticed there was chalk on the ground. And I had bent down to start playing with it. So I grabbed a piece of chalk in my right hand, and I'm outlining my hand like you often see children do, where you're kind of doing like the really rough outline of your hand shape. And she seemed really interested by this. I guess she had not ever seen other humans use chalk or any coloring device like this. And without thinking, I decided, oh, how cool would it be to have her hand. So I grabbed her hand and I started doing the same thing to hers when she had pulled her hand away. And she felt all of a sudden like she was very uncomfortable. I had only gotten 2 fingers of her hand outlined, and she radiated concern and then fear the next moment. And so I took my left hand, and I remember smudging at the picture so it was no longer a recognizable outline. And she seemed a little bit relieved by that. But the reason why I'm bringing it up is she had led me to this beautiful silver craft, and this was an interesting craft that I've seen quite a few times. The craft had no seams on the outside. It was perfectly smooth, and it was slightly reflective. I want to say like a mirror, but not quite the same. You can't see your face to that degree. It's almost like very Very reflective metal. So she had led me into this craft, and there was a long, thin room where she had sat me down, and women began to arrive one by one. And I was looking at these women and thinking, wow, okay, I'm seeing women 20s through 40s, okay. What else am I noticing? Because I've been trying to get more conscious within my encounters to see, what am I noticing? What is occurring around me? Who is playing with my computer? Please stop that. Sorry. Anyway, someone was just playing with my computer. The next thing that I noticed was I looked at this one woman and I said, hey, I know you. And as soon as I said that, she started to have this look of recognition within her eyes of, oh my goodness, why are you talking to me? Followed by, I do know you. Hey, I know you from that group that we're both part of. And then the next thing that happened was this being walked up to her and tapped her on the shoulder, and instantly her eyes went very soft, like she was asleep again, like in a semi-conscious state. So after that, I felt a little bit disheartened, but that was okay. More women arrived, and we all appeared to be, which the part that really threw me off, Dave, is we looked similar in appearance, and we are all healthy. You can feel the vibration of people when they're sick or when they have illness. None of these women were overweight. None of these people had missing limbs. None of these people showed any outward or energetic signs of illness. And then the wall opened up off to the side of me. And the interesting thing that happened next is off to one side of this room, there were three or four separate rooms where certain women were being taken in individually to have almost like one-on-one with doctor type beings. I remember walking around the center of this room, and do you want me to skip past this part of it and go towards more of the encounter that's off-planet?
Well, why don't we hold that thought? Let's hop out for a quick break.
Sure.
And then we'll pick it up right where you left off by saying what the doctors were doing to the ladies who were on this ship with you.
Of course.
All right. You're listening to Spaced Out Radio. Our guest tonight is Samantha Mowat. The ET Experience, every second Tuesday of the month. Tonight is the first episode. She'll be with us right until midnight Pacific, 3 a.m. Eastern. You're listening to Spaced Out Radio. I am your host, Dave Scott. We'll be back after this break.
Have you ever had an extraterrestrial experience? One you just couldn't explain? Well, maybe I can help. Hello, I am Samantha Mowat. On the second Tuesday of each month, I will join Dave Scott on Spaced Out Radio to bring a human aspect to ET contact. It's something I've lived with my entire life, and I'd love to help you understand. Let's share our experiences. The ET Experience, the second Tuesday of each month, only on Spaced Out Radio.
Fairies? Bigfoot? Dogmen? Trolls? Goblins? Hey, if it's cryptid in any way, I'm looking into it. Hi there, this is author Ronald Murphy, also known as Spaced Out Radio's Crypto Guru. Join me every second Wednesday of the month on Spaced Out Radio with Dave Scott, where we will talk about the stories people call tall tales. I will fill you in on the latest sightings and the hidden histories that are causing quite a stir. You can find everything at spacedoutradio.com.
Hi there, this is Jolene with Rivulet Reiki and Readings, and I want you to relax. Let me help you chill out and get in touch with your body, mind, and soul. In this busy world, sometimes we need to let go. And this is where I can help. Visit my website, rivulet.wix.com/rivulet_R&R, or my Facebook page, rivulet_R&R, to set up an appointment for relaxation, Reiki, or readings, no matter where you are. It's time for you to make time for you.
Would you like to expand your clientele? Have you ever thought of online radio advertising? Check out spacedoutradio.com to get your name out there. Our listeners support those who advertise with us, so why not give it a try? We have the most competitive advertising prices out there. Just click on the advertising tab on spacedoutradio.com and contact us today.
Are you an ET experiencer, but you just don't know what's going on? Are you too timid or shy to discuss it with anyone? Maybe I can help. Join me, R. Keith Andrews, the first Friday of every month on Spaced Out Radio, and I will help you to find the answers you're looking for. Together, I will help you understand the off-worlders and the true meanings behind your experiences. All you have to do is join us in the Spaced Out Radio chat room. See you there.
Every Saturday and Sunday night, as Dave Scott wanders aimlessly in the wilderness, you can come hang out with me, James Tyson, in Spaced Out Weekend. Starting at 9 p.m. Pacific, midnight Eastern, I'll take you along as we talk with some of the best experts in their fields. SpacedOutRadio.com is the place to find us. So sit down, relax, put your feet up. Enjoy the topics like the paranormal, supernatural, intuitiveness, and so much more. Hope to see you there.
Hi there. This is your psychic medium, Joanna, and I would love it if you would join us every other Sunday on Spaced Out Weekend. With host James Tyson, we'll bring you personal psychic messages on two mediums and a large. Questions about love, life, career changes. We would love it if you would come and join us live. Call in and listen in for the experience. Allow us to open the doors to your other side. Two mediums and a large, heard only on Spaced Out Weekend at spacedoutradio.com.
Would you like to become one of our space travelers? All you have to do is click on the space travelers icon at spacedoutradio.com. For only $5 a month, you can get access to some great prizes, as well as private monthly shows, newsletters, and a members-only section on our website. Become a space traveler today.
Do you have a topic or a guest that you'd like to hear on Spaced Out Radio? Let us know at spacedoutradio.com, where you can sign up to become a Space Traveler member today. Or you can find us on Twitter at Spaced Out Radio and on our Facebook page, Spaced Out Radio Show. Welcome back to Spaced Out Radio tonight. I am your host, Dave Scott. If you're listening in on the SHR Media Network, thank you so much for tuning in with us on a nightly basis. If you're in the Spaced Out Radio chat room, we appreciate your time as well, along with Euphoria Chronicles Paranormal Forum and the SOR Space Travelers Club on Facebook. If you're a fan of this show and you're on Facebook, you could join that for free and join in the nightly chat. If you want to follow us on Twitter, you can do so at Spaced Out Radio. Give our Facebook page a like, Spaced Out Radio Show. On Instagram, I can be followed at Dave Scott, S-O-R. Our YouTube channel, where we store our archives, is Spaced Out Radio Show, and our website is spacedoutradio.com. Tonight, we are talking with Samantha Mowat, the ET Experience, our newest monthly contribution to this great show that we do every night. The second Tuesday of every month, Samantha will be with us to talk about the experience. Tonight, we're learning a little bit more about her and what brings her to the ET Roundtable on a daily basis. Samantha, thank you so much.
Hi, Dave. Thanks for having me.
Now, right before the break, Samantha, you were telling this incredible story about how you were aboard this ship. You were in a really cold area where there was snow, and you were with a bunch of other women, one that you recognized.
Yes. So, I believe where I left off was mentioning about my friend going blank instantly. Now, what happened after that is we continued to have more women coming in the room. And within a couple moments, the wall opened up behind me. Well, not behind me, more off to my side, thank you. It did not slide open like a sliding glass door, and nor did it swing open like a normal door. It was more as though the wall suddenly opened up, like the particles had changed from being of one property to no longer being present in that location. I should mention that the door was around the size of a balcony door, and gradually the women all began to move through the door and into a very large room. As well, the several ETs, the female guiding ETs that had directed these women into the area, were walking in as well, making sure we were coming through at an appropriate rate. This room was beautiful. It was well lit. It was an off-white color. There were no corners. I don't recall seeing any furniture to clutter up the place. Inside the room, off to one side, there was a basket of puppies, but these puppies didn't look like any puppies that I had ever seen, so I didn't want to touch them. And off to the other side, there were three or four smaller rooms, and within each room, there was one of the women, and what I believed at the time to be either an extraterrestrial instructor or a teacher, or perhaps healer. Now, if you're looking at this room and you're walking through that doorway, Right in the center of the room, you would see this beautiful round garden with trees, shrubbery, various types of plant life, plants that I don't recall ever seeing here on Earth. And I did not... One second. No, definitely not. Nothing that I recall seeing here. Now, as I'm walking around this room, I've noticed that these women are kind of grouped in little sections of three here, four here, two or three here. But most of them didn't seem to be very conscious, so I just kind of wandered around a little bit, looking in rooms. I'd walked into one room, and I was directed out saying, "It's not your time," by the instructor or ET that was in the room. And I noticed that off to the side, there was this little cage of what appeared to be gerbils. And as I walked up to these gerbils, it was kind of interesting, and you guys are going to find this to be probably the most ridiculous thing you've ever heard. They looked very similar to a hamster, like think your little conventional orange hamster that all kids have in elementary school inside a classroom. And I thought I could pass the time by picking it with these little gerbils and either petting it or holding it. Well, one of these gerbils was really not keen on me doing this. He looked at me with his little eyes, and he sent me a very direct, quite angry telepathic message of, "Do not touch us!" And I was really taken aback because animal telepathy isn't something that I had encountered on there before. It was actually quite surprising to me. Although I must admit, afterwards, the ability to communicate animals has gotten quite a fair bit stronger. But the fact that Gerbil had just spoken to me in such a direct manner, and with the energy of that he really didn't like me and didn't want for me to touch him or the beings in his basket, I mumbled an apology and I moved on. I was there for a while, and then what was interesting is we were moved somewhere else, and it was somewhere completely different. And as soon as we walked outside, I knew we were definitely off-world. This was definitely not Earth. It was sunny outside, and the climate was warm. And I remember looking at the sky and loving how vibrant the color was. The colors seemed to be more alive. But I remember seeing more of a pinks and purples to the daylight sky, not the blues that we have. So it was quite interesting, but it looked like we were in a shipyard of sorts and that we were quite high up. Earlier, I was with some extraterrestrials that were instructors, and almost like the being, like the little white female being that had taken me to that area. I was with several of her kind before. But now we were with men as well, and there were some men from Earth, but there were also quite a few men that were not from Earth. And with the men that were not from Earth, they were operating a totally different vibration, and although they looked relatively similar to our men, these men had a much higher frequency. They had strong, emanating masculine energy. They didn't have the same vibration or the exact same appearance as us. Something on their face was different. I remember trying to look at them and go, "What is it that's different about you?" But I couldn't quite put my finger on it. I think looking back now, it's probably the fact they looked healthier. Now, these men, they looked like a soldier. They each looked like soldiers, but their purpose was not to defend or to serve for war. Their purpose felt different. I don't remember what it is at the moment, but each of these men, imagine this, they're wearing a black shirt or a black body suit with this large golden rectangle on their chest. And upon this rectangle are several colored squares, and on each square is a symbol. I cannot recall precisely what the symbols were, nor what their function was, but I feel as though I knew while I was there that these men were a form of guard, and they carried no weapons, and it felt like they could grab each of these symbols or touch one of these symbols, and it would enable them to do something, but I didn't know what. I could feel, just from their energy alone, that they did not carry weapons, and that they were highly capable individuals. No, I do not think these are super soldiers. I must say that right now. And moments later, there was this little boy who had come through, and he fell, and we were really high up. And now from where we were, and we're looking down over the edge, we were probably 5 or 6 stories high. And I remember as I'm looking over the edge, I had this urge in my soul to jump down to save this young one. And telepathically, the thought happened to multiple people all at once, almost like we were in unison, everyone thinking the same thing. Now, several of the men in our party, they set their energy down as they were having this thought, but we were told by one of these beings that if we jumped into that water, the acidity of the water would not be safe for our bodies. They said that the boy that had fallen into the water, was going to be fine, and they were going to look after him. Now, I don't recall much else about that, but that is what I recall from that encounter of being off-world.
Very interesting indeed. I hadn't heard that part of the story before.
I didn't have time. I had to cut a lot out when I had to cut my presentation down by 15 minutes.
I remember that. I do remember that. We are talking with Samantha Mowat tonight on Spaced Out Radio. She is the newest contributor to this show on a monthly basis. Samantha will be with us the second Tuesday of every month for the ET Experience. Samantha, I want to get to some questions here because they're piling up. Eugene is asking in the Spaced Out Radio chat room on Spreaker, Samantha, do you know how the universe interacts and responds to human consciousness?
No, not entirely. I know that the universe seems to respond to us very quickly, and that's why most of us have rapid manifestation. And that is why things seem to be a thought for us and then happen very, very quickly. But for the most part, no, it's something I'm trying to understand but do not know much of at this time. I'm sorry, Eugene.
Gloria is asking in the SOR Space Travelers room. She actually has an implant in her right hip for controlling pain. She can't have MRIs. If these ships have magnetic fields, as you mentioned, what effects would that have on her?
It depends. If they were aware, well, they would be aware of your implant within your hip, Gloria. And as a result, if they were a benevolent one, they would make it so that the ship was not emanating that, well, vibration which would affect you. However, if it is a group that was less than caring, then they wouldn't care if it hurt you or not.
Bill has a question in the SOR Space Travelers. Do they know when they are showing themselves to a first-time experiencer? Is the experience different from those who are not first-timers?
I would say yes, they are very aware of when they're showing themselves for the most part. Bill, you need to take into account that within our energetic field is our aura, and most of these beings are operating with their psychic abilities amplified to a much stronger amount than ours because they use them so regularly, because they are taught to use them, because they're operating at a much faster vibration. For people that have experiences and these beings want to make themselves known or may not necessarily want to make themselves known, people may see a partial image of a being, or they may see an invisible outline, or they may see the being out of the corner of their eye for a moment. It depends on how much they want for that person to notice them. If someone develops their psychic abilities to a larger extent, you can start to see the invisible entities walking around, which, although the extraterrestrial and multidimensional being has cloaked its energy to try to be in harmony or not a detectable vibration, your clairvoyance will begin to pick it up. This is something that everyone is capable of experiencing and developing.
I love this question by Joe in the SOR Space Travelers room because I've never thought of this question and I've never heard this question ever mentioned, just like Joe put on the chat room. Do aliens take photos of us?
I would think so. Probably not in the same manner, though. I don't recall ever seeing a photo on craft, though.
You do? What was that like?
No. I said I don't.
Oh, I thought you said you do. I apologize. Getting back to Bill in the SOR Space Travelers, he says it's a strange question, but I think that this question is very, very legitimate. And you and I have talked about this privately as well. Do any of the different alien races find the male or female human form sexually attractive? Are there any of them we may find attracted to us?
Of course. There's one thing I'd like for you to look up. There is actually a book. One second. Let me think of the name. Oh, goodness. I don't recall the name at this moment. For instance, there are also beings such as many varieties of extraterrestrials, such as, I'm going to have to say it, I'm sorry, there are various kinds of reptilians who do find certain humans, such as our women, depending upon the amount of reptilian DNA that is contained within that woman, to be more enticing. What I'd like for you guys to know is our bodies are made up of different types of extraterrestrial DNA. And as a result, depending upon your lineage, you'll have varying degrees of, let's say, reptilian, or varying degrees of how much Pleiadian, how much white, how much, you name it. There are 12 different kinds. And as a result, those that are higher of, for instance, the reptilian DNA will be more physically appealing to the reptilian race, for the ones that prefer to also breed with human women, than those who, let's say there are two women, and one is high in reptilian DNA, and the other is high in, let's say, more of a gray DNA. To the reptilian female, or male, pardon me, he will find the female human with more of the reptilian DNA more appealing than that of the woman who has more of the gray DNA. That's just an example. One second. I believe there's a book called The Contact Has Begun, by a journalist.
Philip Kraft.
Thank you. I was trying to remember his name. If you can get a hold of that book, there is actually an example of, Dave, would you like to say it?
I can explain that, because I read that book, and I've mentioned this on this show last week. Philip Kraft was with the LA Times as one of its chief editors for over 30 years before he retired. Never had an ET experience, straight up journalist. When he was 63 years old, all of a sudden he gets taken by a group called the Verdants. Mm-hmm. And on the second day of his abduction, which I believe lasted 3 or 4 days, the mm-hmm. female Verdant, her job was...
Gina.
Her job was to explore human sexuality, because they did not use sex per se as mm-hmm. a form of love, as a form of emotion, as a form of physical,
not for pleasure.
Exactly, that's the words I'm looking for. And she was trying to figure that out. So here she's trying to jump the bones of old Philip, and
he's going red in the face, because poor Philip was a very devoted man to his marriage, and he had not had a woman of any species come on to him like that in quite some time.
You know,
I believe Gina said, come on, Phil, do you want to do it? And I remember him saying that he went beet red when she said that.
Well, the funny part about it is I do have a deal with Mrs. Spaced Out Radio. I will never cheat on her on this planet. However, if I must take one for the team and mankind up above in the stars, I already told her I'm going for it. I am going for it, and mm-hmm. we're going to, you know... I laugh as I say that, and I say it with a big smile on my face, because you know Mrs. Spaced Out Radio so well, and she's...
Yes, I do.
She's quite the hottie, I will say that, you know, but we often joke about that, and I'm saying, you know what, honey, I'll never cheat on you, but if the aliens come around and I have to go, I must do this. And she's always... I get the biggest eye roll from that. But let's talk honestly about this, because there's a big thing that is going around recently called love bites.
Love bites are a little bit different. A alien love bite is an extraterrestrial or multidimensional orchestrated attempt relationship between two or more humans as a means of creating energy between those two people. So for people, well, I've been in a love bite, and it's a very unfortunate situation to be in. My love bite actually started in 2014, 2015, and it was with a friend of mine. And what would happen was I would go to sleep at night, and I would encounter this person, and after a while I started to notice there were extraterrestrials popping up. And I began to notice that they were attempting to take my... I've been married for almost 10 years. They were trying to break up my marriage and to have me go into a relationship with this other person. At the time, I wasn't as aware of energy vampires or energy manipulation. And a very common reason for love bites is love bites can start very, very young. Quite often, people who experience a love bite with another person will have instant recognition with that person upon meeting them. They'll feel like they've known them their entire lives. Different than a soulmate. A soulmate or a twin flame will not have the same kind of chaos, drama, and frustration that a love bite will. A love bite will be a euphoric high for days, weeks, months, and then all of a sudden will come to a crashing halt. They will turn off the romantic feelings for one of the parties and leave the other one in more of a, almost like a feeling of depression, hopelessness, and it can be an attempt for energy vampiring. That is one use of love bite. Another is to have a better understanding of the human relationship. If they want, let's say they like the DNA of Sally and they like the DNA of Bill, and they think that, hey, they're both having contact. They both come from contactee families. Let's try to merge their DNAs in order to acquire this trait that we're looking for. Then they may try to arrange for a love bite and have these people meeting up every year, every 6 months, up on craft to get to know each other. What is it about the love bite you're more focused on?
Well, it's more in general about how, in my opinion, and I could be wrong here, it seems like they are trying to exploit what human sexuality is all about. Because we do it for pleasure, we do it for aggression, we do it for raw, pure lust, control, domination for some. Okay, like there's so many different emotions that can be felt in sexual intercourse, and it seems like for a lot of them, they figured out that humanity is either A, controlled by this, or B, they don't understand monogamy.
I would think all of them are relevant. I think a lot of the theories around love bite are very accurate depending upon what group it is you're working with. For some of the different varieties of gray, they don't have the same understanding of love relationships and connection to one another that we do. So for them, bring people up on craft and trying to arrange them to have sex for the purpose of observing or what have you, maybe more viewed on a scientific level versus some others that are wondering, okay, well, why are various humans more dominant sexually? Or they may get one person to unfortunately take advantage of another person. This can be for a number of reasons, trying to understand the energy that happens when the kundalini in one person rises very quickly when they have a strong romantic feeling towards someone versus with the other person who may not have that feeling, seeing how the kundalini energy doesn't rise above the root chakra. You got to remember, energy is a huge part of it for these beings. They are observing it in more than just the way in which we are having it seen. For most people who are viewing it from a five-sense reality, they're only seeing, oh my goodness, I got taken up on craft and I had sex with this strange person I didn't know, and oh my god, the aliens forced me to do this, all horrible, this is terrible, oh my god, they're evil. Well, no, that's from your point of awareness. From the extraterrestrials, it could be, okay, well, I've been taking Sally since she was a child and we like Bill, he's a good person, he's got good energy, he's very compatible, they're very similar. Oh look, his energy raised up towards his heart because he has these romantic feelings for her. Oh, why did Sally's not go above her root chakra? Why does she not have the same energetic release that he does? So depending upon which group it is, they could be looking at it for very different reasons.
Joe has a question in the Space Out Radio Space Travelers Club on Facebook. He's watching a lot of military flights over his house in California tonight. Most he can hear, some he can't. Do extraterrestrials ever disguise their craft with blinking lights to make them appear to be regular craft?
I would say so. I haven't seen them do the blinking light things, but that does seem like a strategic thing for them to do.
Well, they do try and camouflage themselves, but I don't really know if they need to with their speed, that's for sure.
No, but if they're aware that you've already seen them, then wouldn't it be easier just to make it appear in your mind that, oh, look, I'm seeing a plane, or oh, look, I'm seeing a plane at night, rather than trying to go through the effort of changing your mind from viewing something to viewing nothing?
Lori has a question in the SOR chat room on Spreaker. Have you ever been introduced to an ET family? If so, what was the interaction like?
Let me think. No, I don't believe so. I've met various members that I've had as members of my family in past lives, such as some of the Tans and a few Palladians. But no, I don't recall meeting a ET family in its core unit.
Would that be interesting to you to see and learn how the family structure works on an extraterrestrial level?
Yes, of course. I'd love to see how their family dynamic is. I think it would differ from ours immensely because theirs would be at a much, for the most part, healthier system than ours. They wouldn't have the same complexes of drama that we do. So it'd be quite interesting to see.
A couple times it's come up in the chat rooms that quite often you were talking to your guides to get information. No, don't apologize. I think people are finding that very intriguing that you're quickly going to your guides. How does that work for you?
Oh, it's so easy. Okay, so for instance, right now I'm just sitting in one of my kitchen chairs and I'm at my computer desk. And what I do typically with my guides is most of my information comes through either clairvoyantly or claircognizantly. So I either see stuff either with my physical eyes or within my third eye, or I have instant downloads of information, both of which are very easy to learn. I'm putting them up on YouTube, but we'll get to that another time. So within my day-to-day life, it doesn't matter if I'm on Spaced Out Radio, talking to a client, talking to someone, even my friends, it's very common for me to ask my guides. I try to do it more telepathic communication with them rather than verbally asking because it tends to make people a little either uncomfortable or I feel a little bit silly if I forget that I've said something out loud rather than in my head. What I do is I just, let's say right now you're like, hey Sam, okay. Let's say you just asked me a question. If I don't know the information or I completely forget one of my encounters and I forget whether, let's say, it was a small mushroom being or a flower being, I could ask my guides, hey, was it this or was it that? And they'll be like, well, in that time it was this. And be like, oh, thank you. Carry on. It's a very simple process. Everyone who's psychic typically will do this. It's just a matter of getting used to doing it in your day-to-day life rather than just sitting down with a deck of cards to do something. This is what I believe you are all capable of, and it does make life a lot easier. I may seem like I'm laughing a lot or giggling a lot. It's because I've also got a background of other people talking, and it's a little bit silly sometimes when they're laughing either what I say or if I say something funny or I've got two people talking in my head at once trying to have different things being said. It's not schizophrenia. It's completely different. Schizophrenics tend to have people saying, go do bad things. When you're talking with different extraterrestrial groups or different multidimensional groups, which, by the way, the angels, all angelic beings, fairies, your deceased loved ones, they're all operating on different dimensions, so really you can see them as multidimensional beings. So when you're having that different multidimensional hearing, it makes life entertaining, and that's really the best way to see it.
We are going to take a break here at the top of the hours. Samantha Mowat is our guest tonight. The ET Experience happens every second Tuesday of the month with Samantha Mowat. Her website is samanthamowat.ca. You're listening to Spaced Out Radio. I am your host, Dave Scott. We'll be back after this break.
Become more intimate and interactive with Spaced Out Radio. Join our Space Travelers Club with your new membership. For $5 a month, we'll provide you with special access to the website, monthly prize draws from books to psychic readings, along with monthly newsletter, private interviews, and more. Sign up today to be part of Spaced Out Radio's experience.
Every month on Spaced Out Radio, we look into the deep and dark reports of cryptids roaming around the world with me, Rob Morphy, from Cryptopia.us. I would love it if you would join me and host Dave Scott as we delve into the most arcane stories and reports regarding creatures of the unknown. My job is to hunt down the details and bring the evidence forward to you. These aren't your regular Bigfoot stories I'm talking about either. You can find out more about crypto history at spacedoutradio.com.
Looking for a place to advertise at a very reasonable cost? Look no further than Spaced Out Radio. SpacedOutRadio.com has an advertising tab that you can click to check out our daily, weekly, and monthly packages to play on the radio, or our website including social media. From commercial spots to banners, we have it all. Check out our competitive pricing today.
You
You hear footsteps in the empty room above you. A rocking chair begins rocking by itself. Don't be afraid of the things that go bump in the night. Reach for Spirit Storybox, the iPhone app the Huffington Post UK called the only ghost hunting app you will ever need. Spirit Storybox. The spirits are telling their stories. Are you listening?
Strange creatures lurking in the night, the sounds of wood knocking in the forest, odd happenings right out of a fictional world. These are the reports I love. Hi there, this is author Ronald Murphy, and I would love it if you join me and Spaced Out Radio host Dave Scott the second Wednesday of every month on our journey into the unknown land of cryptozoology at spacedoutradio.com. From Mothman to Frogman and everything in between. Hey, they don't call me the crypto guru for nothing.
Is the 24-hour world starting to wear you down? Let me, from Rivulet Reiki and Readings, lend you a hand. Hi, this is Jolene. And if you're in need of Reiki or a realm reading, come to my website, rivulet.wix.com/rivulet_R&R, and let us help you out. At Rivulet, I specialize in healing your body, mind, and soul, no matter where you are. And be sure to check out the Rivulet R&R Facebook page for your best deals. Remember, it's time for you to make some time for you.
Find yourself constantly looking up in the sky, looking for answers? Have you had extraterrestrial contact? Are you an abductee? Looking for answers to your experiences? Hi there, I'm R. Keith Andrews, Spaced Out Radio's resident ET expert. Join me live the first Friday of every month where I take questions from the Spaced Out Radio chat room and help you understand those from the far-off world. It's 2 hours of knowledge every experiencer should listen to. Hope to see you there.
Did you know that Spaced Out Radio runs 7 days a week? Hi, it's James Tyson from Spaced Out Weekend. Every Saturday and Sunday night, starting at 9 p.m. Pacific, midnight Eastern, you can join me and my guests for some great chatter about what's going on out in the universe or even in that dark part of the basement you really don't want to go back into. Well, let's find the answers to your experiences together. So come on up to Uncle Jimbo's cabin on the weekend. For more information, look us up at spacedoutradio.com.
Would you like to connect with us on Spaced Out Radio? Head to spacedoutradio.com to check out the latest shows, guests, and sponsors. And don't forget to sign up for the Space Travelers Club. You'll find all you need at spacedoutradio.com.
Welcome back to Space Out Radio for the final hour tonight as we do this thing 7 days a week, 3 hours a night at spacedoutradio.com and on Spreaker. If you're tuning in on the SHR Media Network, thanks for listening in. If you're in the Space Out Radio chat room, we appreciate your time as well, along with Paranormal Forum and on Facebook, Euphoria Chronicles and the SOR Space Travelers Club. Appreciate everybody being with us tonight. How are y'all doing? Remember, if you want to follow us on social media, you can do so at Spaced Out Radio. Give our Facebook page a like, Spaced Out Radio Show. On Instagram, I can be followed at Dave Scott, S-O-R. Our YouTube channel, where we store our archives, you can subscribe to it by typing in Spaced Out Radio Show. And our website is spacedoutradio.com. The ET Experience tonight on Spaced Out Radio with Samantha Mowat. She joins us the second Tuesday of every month. This is the inaugural show with her, and Samantha's website is spacedoutradio.com. Thank you so much for joining us.
That's your website.
Oh, yes, your website. I apologize, SamanthaMowat.ca. You know,
awesome.
We're going to link the two so that way you can find Samantha the chat room, and that just totally just blew my entire momentum there. That's okay, though. You know what? Claudia is going to start things off here with a question for you.
Wonderful.
And it comes with a comment as well. She says, sometimes when she is semi-meditating, having her eyes closed, she likes to She asks to travel and see someone on another planet. A few times, she has seen like a lit up path that she could walk down out in space, and she sees a woman like a bluish spirit. So beautiful. She walks up to Claudia and bows, and Claudia bows back. Now, Claudia looks around at the stars and sees planets. So her question is, have you, Samantha, ever met an ET that looks like that, and is she Pleiadian?
I don't recall meeting Pleiadians like that. Claudia, when you say she's blue, what do you mean? Is she bipedal? Is she wearing clothing? Is she more crystalline? Is she more flesh? I need to know more, please.
Okay, we'll have to wait for that response. While we're waiting for that response from Claudia...
Claudia, mostly blue beings that I have met that are one shade of blue or similarity of blue to another have been various kinds of Arcturians. They are the most common blue beings I have met outside of crystalline beings, which typically are of more of a blue color vibration. I have not met Pleiadians that were blue, but I did give a reading to a woman. I believe she was from Texas, either. I can't remember if she was my Friday from Texas or my Monday from Texas. Anyways, both of which were star seeds. I believe it was my Monday, and she had a blue woman, an energetic woman. That was her guide. That was more of an extraterrestrial. I believe she was Arcturian, though.
Claudia is saying that the being that she is meeting up with was more like a crystallized being.
It's probably a crystal being of some sort, probably coming down from a much higher vibration. You got to remember, the Pleiades aren't operating at a much higher vibration than us. They're only operating on the 5th to 6th density. A lot of the crystalline beings are coming down from much higher, say 8, 9, 10. So their vibration is slowing down to be on our wavelength. And they become more crystalline because they are operating much faster. They are very pure, beautiful. You do almost want to cry because you feel the goodness radiating from their soul. To me, that sounds more, like you said, like a crystalline being rather than a Pleiadian. Pleiadians, you can feel the human, well, form of human energy within them. You can feel the good and the bad, the variation. I hope that helps.
What do the Pleiadians look like?
For the most part, the ones that I've met are very similar to us. They do not have the skin blemishes we do. So they don't have freckles, they don't have moles, they don't have the same wrinkles, they don't have the discoloration within their skin. Their vibration is faster than us because they were able to be a more spiritually advanced race. For the most part, I've only seen Pleiadians having straight hair. I have not seen curly hair. The majority of that I have met when it comes to males, their hair is around shoulder length, which is fine. The other half of my soul is Pleiadian, and his hair is red rather than blonde. Everyone says Pleiadians only come in blonde. Well, that's not true. That would be just from one star within the Pleiades. Now, the female Pleiadians that I met one that does have a slight wave to her hair, and who, when I first saw her, she was very excited to show me that she finally had curls for the first time because she was able to change her hair to looking like that at that moment, but then she had to release them a minute later. She was just playing with the energy within her hair. Most of the Pleiadians that I have met either have blonde hair, red hair, although I have met a few brunette ones. One second. On average, they're definitely taller than me, but that's not hard. Closer towards 5'10 through 6.5 feet tall on average. Very slim, almost like they're well-formed bodies, very healthy. They do not have the same unhealthy fat deposits that we tend to have. They don't tend to hold on to, their chakras are clear, and as a result, they don't hold on to weight around their chakras or have the same bodily issues that we have when think of our feet going numb because our energy isn't circulating properly. Their hair is, well, it's different than ours in the sense that their hair looks like it's thicker for the hair, but doesn't look like they have as many. Most humans tend to have a lot of hair. I have never seen facial hair on a male Pleiadian. Typically when I see them in one of two ways. When I see them at home, they tend to be wearing more robe type outfits, more not elven like Lord of the Ring outfits. That's definitely not what I mean when I say robe, and I don't mean medieval robes. I mean more almost like they're very simple, not very decorated, but they almost look like they're very light material, either cotton or some sort of weave similar to that. They are quite stoic and very, very polite, but when they're traveling, so when they're out on craft, they tend to be wearing more of the protective suits when they do see us, because we do have a lot of chemicals on our body that are even radiating outward, and that is why you will see many different types of extraterrestrials, Pleiadians, Greys, you name it, who have their outfits that go from wrist to throat all the way down their body, covering their feet. Because we do have debris, and not just energetic debris. I mean, think of when people are in a war zone and they have been exposed to other toxic gases or things of that nature, how it's emanating out of their physical body. We have the same kind of pollution coming out of ours, and that's why they're protecting theirs. Thank you for dealing with my rant.
Oh, no problem. I had a gentleman on last night who claimed to be Pleiadian, and a lot of what you've said tonight came from him, but yours was on a much more positive level. Not saying that he was being negative, but I tend to believe that he was the real deal, you know, just by my own channeling sessions with extraterrestrials, which you have seen me do. And you could tell by the tone of his voice, in my opinion, because it was very monotone. It wasn't fluctuating.
Well,
and
they don't have the same degree of emotional fluctuation we do. Please continue.
Anyways, he was saying, I was telling him about our experience in the forest. He believed, after I described the creatures that we saw, or the beings that we saw, he believed them to be Andromedans. What do you believe they were? Because you saw it much better than I did.
I never even... Dave, when I see them, I don't think to ask half the time. And that is something that another friend of ours has given me quite a bit of heck over. I see them and I'm just happy to see them. I don't think to ask names. I don't think to ask locations. When I do find out roughly what race they are, it's because I've gone, huh, what the heck are you? And sometimes they're nice enough to give me a race, and other times they say, well, this is just my body for this lifetime. They could be Andromedans, but I don't know. I'm sorry, but I don't know.
Shame on you. Shame on you. This is my life question here that's going on here, because you were there for this emotional yet odd experience.
And beautiful experience.
It was beautiful. You know, honestly, I have invited them back every day since, once I realized that I was okay. I do have to tell a funny story about this. I don't know if you remember. A couple days after this event with you and I.
Yeah, when I went to your house?
Nope. Nope. Okay. I crawled into bed. It was about 1:30 in the morning, because 2:00 in the morning, because here's old Davey doing all this research trying to figure out what the heck we had seen. And I crawl into bed. I remember it's late, and I have a big king-size bed. I snuggle up to Mrs. S.O.R., who's in the flannel pajamas, as per usual. And all of a sudden, every hair on my body stands up, and I hear this telepathic voice behind me say, "Hey, can you turn on over? We're here to say hello." And I went, "No, I'm not ready for this. You know, I don't want to turn over." And they're like, "Oh, come on. We're not taking you. We're just here to say hello. Just turn on over." And he was behind me on my side of the bed. Anyways, him and I are arguing about this for about 5-6 minutes. And he's like, I'm like, "Dude, you have to respect my free will. I'm not ready to turn over. I don't want to see you. I am not turning over." He's like, "Oh, just come on. We're not taking you. We're just here to say hello and introduce ourselves." And I'm like, "No."
So why didn't you get them to talk to you and say, "Okay, well, what's your name?"
I was too scared.
Touche.
I was way too scared and way too unready. I was unprepared. You know, so I played my free will card, much like I would in Monopoly, and he all of a sudden went, "Oh, okay, we'll see you again next time." I think those were the guys who actually took me, to be honest with you, when I woke up on the table implanted. But that's for another night, another story. I think that was them, because I like them. They were fun. They were fun. I got a question from Eugene in the Space Out Radio Space Travelers room on Facebook. Samantha, what have your guides revealed to you about life after death?
Eugene, I've asked my guides so much about life after death, it's not even funny. Well, one thing that they've shown me is two different things. We do tend to reincarnate. Typically, there tends to be at least 5 to 10 years or more between incarnations. When I asked my guides to explain to me more about life after death, they thought the best way to explain it to me was to allow me to start seeing my previous incarnations. They've shown me a couple different things. They have shown me that we are, in part, depending upon our belief system and our vibration, able to leave Earth when we pass. You don't necessarily hit the ground every time and every being come back down to Earth into a body. That's not necessarily what happens. Some beings do just go home. For some, they do end up, well, unfortunately, hitting the grid and then waiting for a body and then going into a body again, not necessarily picking the life that they have, but that's something we'll get into another time. They have shown me heavenly-type places, which is a little bit surprising to me. When I was growing up, I grew up Catholic, and then when I became a teenager, I stopped believing in a lot of that altogether. And as I continued to go along this journey with my guides, with extraterrestrials, I actually found it quite interesting to learn that most extraterrestrial races believe in a form of deity and do believe in some form of heaven-type place. So for me, that was something that kind of knocked my socks off, and it took a long time for me to be willing to accept that again. This one time, Eugene, and I'm sorry to kind of venture off for a little bit, but just bear with me. I was giving a reading to another woman, and as I was giving a reading to her, her energy kept pulling back, and she kept shaking her head, but she kept telling me to go on. And after a while, about 20 minutes, I had to stop her, and I said, "Is everything all right? I'm getting the impression that this reading isn't going as you had hoped." And then she looks at me and she's like, "I'm sorry. I'm a medium, and I had been talking to this woman about some extraterrestrial stuff she was encountering, because she had mentioned having encounters and wanted to know more about that. And she was telling me how, you know what, I'm smelling cigarettes, and I'm smelling beer, and I've got this man whose name is Gord here, and he wants to talk to you." Well, my father-in-law had just passed about a month or two before. Now, what was interesting is I saw quite a few angelic beings moving around in the background, and it wasn't until that she had passed on that message to me about him and gave me further detail around that situation that I was actually willing to believe my guides about what they had said when it comes to heaven, because he had told me, he started to talk through this woman about it and part of the life after death aspect. Which part are you more curious about, Eugene, when it comes to life after death?
Eugene is a very highly intelligent medium as well, psychic medium as well, with a very expanded knowledge when it comes to the science behind what everything is happening, at least. And so we'll have to wait for his comment in regards to that. But he will fill in. I do know that. I can feel his fingers right now starting to type in regards to this.
One thing they have shown me around it is they have shown energy. Well, my guides gave a bit of a video. Energy separating from the body, having other energies around, and that the energy that is separated from the body having the choice whether they choose to stay around Earth for a while. They're observing loved ones, walking around, not ready to go, you name it, their choice, or whether they wish to move forward. Which is fine, in which case the energy goes from being from a human outline but an energy over towards being more of a spherical ball, more of the God, source, divine energy, whatever it is you wish to call it. That is what they have shown me around life after death.
Claudia is asking in the Space Out Radio Space Travelers Club on Facebook, have you ever, Samantha, been healed for illnesses by extraterrestrials?
Quite a few times. I was actually quite sick on my last trip to the island, which was in March, and I don't normally get sick, but this time I did, and when it did, it actually kind of knocked me, I hate to say it, but knocked me on my ass. I was barely able to stay awake in the day. I would be up long enough to have a few sips of water, drink a little bit of ginger ale type thing, and pass back out on the couch for about 4 or 5 days. And after day 3 of going through this, I thought, this is ridiculous. Guides, all the beings I work with, somebody come make me feel better because I can't handle this. And so the next day, I had a different type of being come to see me that night. But I had the second night after I had asked, a really lovely being come to see me. She was a variety of gray, but not like the short grays. She was around five foot something, I would say. She's around my height from where she was. She was sitting on my bed, and I was laying there. And what I remember was I could feel her giving me healing energy, and she was just about to leave. And this is going to sound a little bit ridiculous, but she had black hair, like bangs, thin bangs. And she had black hair around, like our hair, except it went to about her shoulders. I remember that she was leaning over me, and I put my hand up to caress her forehead and to slightly run my fingers through her hair. And I remember saying, "I love your hair. Thank you." And I fell back asleep. That is the last time they had healed me. If you like, Claudia, I can share either after this or next time on Spaced Out Radio, or even do a whole segment on ET and healing, because most of them are very, very healing beings.
Mm-hmm. I want to get into what... Okay, Eugene has just responded, sorry, in regards to his question. The levels of after-death consciousness and problem of lapses in the after-death consciousness. How can one retain and recall every sequential event in NDE, so near-death experiences, mm-hmm. or abduction experiences?
One second, let me think of the best way to phrase that. I don't believe you can hold on to absolutely every event. I really don't when it comes to your near-death experience necessarily, or your life, well, your near-death experiences or any abduction. Because when it comes to the abduction, they can be revealed back to you like onion layers, where you remember part and then you remember more of it later and later and later as time goes on, as you begin to explore and more details come through. Depending upon the level of consciousness you have, that will determine your vibration. The vibration that you are emitting at your time of death can also determine where it is your soul goes after you pass. If you are operating at a very fear-based vibration because you've just suffered through a traumatic or sudden death, then unfortunately it is possible to go down to that lower astral, which I believe, Eugene, you're probably quite well aware of. Now, it also depends upon what it is your soul believes in. If your soul doesn't believe in it ever having the possibility to go towards something such as hell or anything of that nature, then you are not likely to be able to be sucked down towards the lower astral. However, if your soul believes that you're just going to hang out in the ground, or you're just going to come back here no matter what, then that will happen. I'm sorry, what was the other part?
Oh, and then Corrine is asking a follow-up question to Eugene's. In regards to what you just said, what if you have Alzheimer's?
Your body may have Alzheimer's. Your soul does not have Alzheimer's. When people typically develop Alzheimer's, it is because they are not able to handle the vibration, the memories, and the things they have encountered within that life, and their soul is trying to gently exit. It does not mean that because you have Alzheimer's that you will necessarily be in stasis upon death. Rather, when your body, your physical body dies, your soul will no longer be feeling the burden of the body, and it will go wherever it chooses to go, which for most is home, because they can't handle the vibration and the energy here on Earth.
We're going to hop out for our final break of the night. When you come back, or when we come back, you will hear more from Samantha Mowat. We're going to get more into ETs. The ET Experience, the second Tuesday of every month here on Spaced Out Radio. Samantha Mowat is our guest. Her website, samanthamowat.ca. You're listening to Spaced Out Radio. I am your host, Dave Scott. We'll be right back after this.
Are you interested in advertising on Spaced Out Radio?
Head to our website at spacedoutradio.com and click on our advertising tab. There you will find an assortment of ways you can get your product out there with us.
From the radio, commercials, to banners, to social media.
Have a product you'd like our host to endorse? We can do that too.
Visit spaceoutradio.com for more details.
Visit purpleplates.com today. For over 40 years, the Purple Energy Plates have been delivering amazing results for their many customers. Inspired by the great genius Nikola Tesla, the harmony, healing, and energetic effects of the plates have proven over and over to be beneficial and often miraculous to thousands of customers. With their money-back guarantee and the many benefits, how can you afford not to get one? Check their site for daily specials and choose from their many energy products. You won't be sorry.
Right here, this is where we divulge the fruit of our research. Here on the Webster Phenomena every Saturday night at 8 p.m. Pacific. 11 p.m. Eastern, on Spaced Out Radio.
Attention, Spaced Out Radio listeners. For only $5 a month, you can join Spaced Out Radio Space Travelers. Your membership at spacedoutradio.com will give you access to private fan area on the website, get you a monthly newsletter, draws for monthly swag, and a whole lot more. Sign up today to become a part of the Spaced Out Radio experience.
Strange creatures lurking in the night, the sounds of wood knocking in the forest, odd happenings right out of a fictional world. These are the reports I love. Hi there, this is author Ronald Murphy, and I would love it if you join me and Spaced Out Radio host Dave Scott the second Wednesday of every month on our journey into the unknown land of cryptozoology at spacedoutradio.com. From Mothman to Frogman and everything in between. Hey, they don't call me the crypto guru for nothing.
Greetings and salutations, space travelers, from the Chronicles of the Unknown team.
What is Chronicles of the Unknown? I keep hearing about this thing.
It's a new paranormal reality TV show based right here in beautiful British Columbia, Canada. Follow our team as we uncover claims of activity on the Caribou Gold Rush Trail. You can also follow us here every third Monday, where two members of our team will be available to answer your questions. We'll give you some equipment updates and some of our experiences on the road, right here on Spaced Out Radio.
The last Monday of the month on Spaced Out Radio is a night of psychic vision, mediumship, UFO and ET contact, Bigfoot stories, animal communication, and so much more with me, Elizabeth Anglin. I'd love it if you would join host Dave Scott and I on the myriad of topics we delve into. Every month, we share new views that may help you understand your own experiences. So tune on in at spacedoutradio.com and stamp your cosmic passport.
Did you know that Spaced Out Radio runs 7 days a week? Hi, it's James Tyson from Spaced Out Weekend. Every Saturday and Sunday night, starting at 9 p.m. Pacific, midnight Eastern, you can join me and my guests for some great chatter about what's going on out in the universe or even in that dark part of the basement you really don't want to go back into. Well, let's find the answers to your experiences together. So come on up to Uncle Jimbo's cabin on the weekend. For more information, look us up at spacedoutradio.com.
Missed most of tonight's show? Don't worry, you didn't miss a thing. You can head to our website, spacedoutradio.com, and download our archives for free. And don't forget to get your Space Travelers membership today. Now, back to tonight's show.
Welcome back to the final half hour of Spaced Out Radio tonight. I am your host, Dave Scott. We've rounded third. We're heading for home here on the mighty SOR. Tomorrow night on the show, the crypto guru, Ronald Murphy, will be back with us. We're talking werewolves. We're talking dogman. Maybe a little goblins as well. Love Ronald Murphy, the crypto guru, when he is on the air. If you want to follow us on Twitter, you can do so at Spaced Out Radio. Give our Facebook page a like, Spaced Out Radio Show. On Instagram, I can be followed at Dave Scott, S-O-R. Our YouTube channel, where we store our archives, is Spaced Out Radio Show. You can subscribe to that. And, of course, our website is spacedoutradio.com. For the final time tonight, we introduce Samantha Mowat. Her website, samanthamowat.ca. And on every second Tuesday of the month, Samantha will be joining us for the ET Experience. Samantha, thank you so much for doing this. I hope you've had fun.
I've had a great time, Dave. Thank you for having me.
Right on. We're going to start off with some questions from the SOR Space Travelers Room. This one from Claudia. Mm-hmm. Do ETs sleep, or do they just go into a meditative state?
Some sleep, yes. Pleiadians, from what I've noticed, do have their own homes, and most of them, from what I've seen, do have beds. So yes, I would say sleeping is definitely what is going on there, besides the obvious coitus, because yes, they do engage in that. I have never seen beds when it comes to most other extraterrestrial type races. I haven't seen any beds for human or for grays or tans. I haven't seen any for crystalline beings. One second, pardon me. Thank you. From what I've seen, I've only seen the Pleiadians having the beds. When it comes to small mushroom or flower beings, I haven't noticed any. Same with the varying varieties of grays, I haven't noticed any. Reptilians, I have no idea.
Joe is asking if on Earth, when the extraterrestrials are here, do they recognize each other? Like, do greys know all the other greys? Do reptilians know other reptilians?
I would say they were able to either recognize the unique energetic signature that is emitted by those beings, or they would be able to see them if they are hosting someone, seeing them, standing behind them.
Wow.
You've got to remember, they can see better than we can. They're seeing more of the energetic signature. You can put on a facade and make it so the people around you all believe they are seeing one type of person, when really you are a different type.
There is a lot of negativity around extraterrestrials, and I don't want to make this a negative show or end it on a negative connotation. That's not really where I'm going with this. But no. In regards to extraterrestrials and people having a negative outlook on them, do you believe that it has a lot to do with Hollywood, with authors, with video games, with the media stereotype that goes along with that, in order to keep people fearing of this subject, to maybe keep disclosure from ever happening?
Not just disclosure from ever happening, but Dave, there's also a huge priority to make it so that if people fear these beings, they will not interact with these beings, they will not be able to gain further awareness of what their true situation is like here on Earth. They will not retain their memories from their past lives. For those who are starseeds, they will not be able to even access that information easily if there is a fear blocking it. I don't necessarily believe that everything out there on ETs is negative. I believe that some which is depicted, perhaps, in one perspective as negative, may not be looking at it from all angles. For a long time, I thought some of my ET encounters were negative, until I actually learned what they were doing and why they were doing it. When I've, for instance, I've found myself on tables before, and I've actually started asking, hey, why am I here? What are you doing? To give you an example of that, yes, there is a lot of negative things out there between Hollywood, the news, you name it, but that's just here. If you look at the fact that China has already released a lot of information on their extraterrestrials, same with France, Russia is doing the same thing. It is very much so a Western thing at this time to be holding back a lot of that information, but it will change. Now, where I was going with that is when I had said earlier, a few minutes ago, about believing something is negative when and then learning that you may not have been interpreting it the right way. Earlier this year, someone who I had felt was a good girlfriend of mine has been doing energetic implant removals. And my guide said, you don't need this. If you're really keen on getting your implants out, you can just get rid of them yourself. And so I decided I was going to remove all energetic implants that I had. I had been told by someone that they were all bad, which is not true. Please, I'd like to get back into that one sec. And so I spent about one really, really thorough evening going through my energetic body, and anywhere I felt one, I was sending massive amounts of energy to get rid of it. Well, the next night, I had these greys ever so persistently, and not bad greys, good greys, trying to have me come up on craft. And I kept thinking, okay, well, I'm not going. Nope, you can't make me. I will stay awake. And even though they were trying to change my energetic vibration to be on more of a sleep feeling, I was being a stubborn little monkey. So the next night, I fell asleep thinking, okay, well, they're not going to try again for a while. And as soon as I was asleep, I found myself in an underground place, and I was running, and I thought, and I was running away from these three beings, and I was running with another woman. Now, the other woman decided she was tired, and I told her, we're in the astral, you can't get tired, just keep changing your energy, keep moving it forward. And they had collected her, and a while later they collected me. Now, you may feel as though this is fear-based. Please, that's not where I'm going. I saw her laying on the table, and then I noticed they were up by her head with a human, and they were changing an implant that was in her body. So I didn't remember having the implant changed or applied into me, but the next day I was asking my guides, I'm like, okay, what was going on there? And they said, you had removed an implant that was put in for your health. And the reason they were being so persistent in trying to collect you is because you require it in order to stay healthy. And so I realized that where I had come across this information that was being presented to me by someone else who I had trusted as being essential, so the implant removal, saying all implants were bad, but then these beings were putting implants into me to help keep me at a more healthy state. Although information on the internet will tell you that all ET implants are bad, in my experience and point of understanding, that's not the case. Does that help you?
Well, I think that it does bring up a little controversy, because I can see in the chat rooms it kind of stirs the emotions of a lot of people. And to be honest with you, and don't take offense to this audience when I say this, but it's the American crowd who has a lot of the, I don't want to say fear, but the questioning in regards to it.
The concern.
And I strongly believe, and this is my opinion, that it had to do with the deal that was made between Eisenhower and the Draco Greys back in 1955, I believe, in regards to trading humans and animals for technology. That's what I believe, because Canada did not make a deal.
Not at that time.
We seem to have a lot more positive experiences up here than negative experiences. So, you know, but Gloria in the SOR Space Travelers room, she brings up a good point. She mm-hmm. says, sorry, but if it hurts, I will usually consider that as a negative.
I agree. If you're having pain with it, then that could be a negative one. Gloria, I'm not trying to undermine yours. I'm merely saying this is what my one was. Mine, they told me, was to help keep my body in balance when it comes to my pH, because that's something that I have difficulties with within this form. Until I had this implant, I actually got quite sick and had my body going towards the acidic very easily. And my body was starting to develop cancer twice until they had decided to put this one in. Which is, I'm quite grateful that they have. If you like, you can look into using your own energy to remove these implants if you are feeling that there's something you don't want.
Joe mm-hmm. has a question in the Space Travelers Club here on Facebook. Is Earth one of the most violent planets out there?
In my experience, yes. If I'm given a choice, I will not come back here. Not a chance if I have a choice. But, Joe, I do want for you to know that, yes, it is violent, but think of how much we've changed in the last couple hundred years. Now, on one hand, we've actually become less violent because we're becoming more aware of how we interact with one another. I believe it is just a matter of time before we reach the 100 monkey syndrome, where overall we do stop being a violent race.
When you feel mm-hmm. something negative coming on compared to something positive, mm-hmm. how are you able to tell the difference, and how are you able to prepare for it?
Okay, when you're feeling something that is positive, your energy will maintain feeling in harmony. You will still feel peaceful. You will feel safe. Think of how you feel when someone you love comes near you, when they enter a room. You don't feel a strong energetic change. It feels as though everything is still maintaining harmony. But when you have someone enter into your area and they are not having a kind intention, whether it is a human, whether it is an extraterrestrial, you can feel it. All women know this as that predatory feel when we are walking down the street and you can feel someone watching you and they don't have the best intentions for you. The one thing that you're able to do around this is, what I do is I actually change the way in which my energy is vibrating. Instead of going to a further fear-based state, which is what I used to in the past because that was what I was taught to do and what I picked up from other people, I change my vibration to being a very high one, so I go straight towards my heart chakra and I expand my energy body. I pull tremendous amounts of source, God's energy, whatever you want to call it, into my heart and I expand my energy, and then I put up energy protection around my house. My current house is shaped like a rectangle. So what I would do is I would put a pillar of white light or love in each corner of my house, and then I would connect those four pillars. I would imagine a line going from the far left corner to the far right to the close right to the close left up to the far left. And I would just end up doing something such as, well, going over the floor and over the ceiling, and either set the intention of only things that come in peace, love, and light matter, and everything else can't handle the vibration, or you can ask your angels and guides to keep things away. But what I have found is when I do encounter some malevolent ETs, if I do go into a fear-based state at all, they tend to really feed off that. So when I do encounter, let's say, large black reptilians, what I end up doing is I do pull a lot of love in, because they don't like that vibration. Even some of the not nice grays do not like the love vibration, because when you're operating at that vibration, it's very hard for them to stand being in your presence. I hope that helps.
Claudia has a question for you. On other planets, do all thoughts manifest... excuse me. On all other planets, do all thoughts manifest instantaneously? Is there another reason Samantha is choosing her words carefully?
Actually, Claudia, it's not really me choosing my words carefully. This is typically how I do end up speaking, which is probably, I believe, frustrating for most people. No, things do not manifest absolutely instantaneously on absolutely every other planet. If a planet is operating at a higher vibration and the life forms that are living within said planet, within said planet, are operating on a higher vibration, then they will be able to manifest things very quickly to instantaneously. If not, just like on Earth, if you have lower vibrational entities, be it humans or anything lower than us, on a high vibrational planet, the rate of manifestation will be quicker than it would be on Earth at this present time. However, they would not be able to manifest things instantly until they gain full control over their mind. And one thing I do need to say, Claudia, in regards to that, is whenever I'm doing any form of channeling, it does sound as though I'm picking my words very carefully, because it's not me speaking.
What about grounding? Does grounding help?
Grounding is good if you're feeling lightheaded and spacey. The purpose of grounding is if your energy body is going from your knees upward and connecting more to the space around you rather than going down and being present. Like, let's say you're feeling anxious, or you're feeling as though you can't focus, your eyes are hurting, and you're unable to actually concentrate, then grounding is a great thing to do. Even if you're feeling scattered, full of other people's energy, grounding will help clear your own energetic being. But as far as protection is concerned, no, grounding does very little. You can do white light. The only reason why I say white light, golden bubble, is white light has a very high vibration. White contains all the colors of the rainbow. Gold is the color that you'll find with most ascended masters, because it is a very high love vibration.
What about putting a mirror around the golden bubble? I have heard from people such as Max Steele on this show say that if you are being attacked by a negative entity or extraterrestrial, if you put a mirror in, it will actually either send that energy right back to them, or the mirror will actually, if the being is in spiritual form, will actually suck the being into it, and that's where the being stays.
Which I think that could easily work. I haven't done the mirror technique. My only concern regarding that one, with the being sucked in, is if you do not remember to get rid of said mirror or to clear said mirror, then you're carrying that being around with you, projecting it towards those around you. You're keeping that energetic signature in your being, or within the vicinity of your being.
I do have to ask you this. A couple moments ago when you were talking about... Mm-hmm. The negativity, there was a growl that came through your feed.
Oh, it's my puppy. I'm sorry. She's whining at me. She wants to go pee.
Well, she has to wait about 10 minutes.
Yes, she does.
Because we're all like, oh my goodness, was that an ET coming through and all this kind of stuff? All right.
Well, it's a German Shepherd. I mean, she's kind of crazy.
Yes. I got to get me one of those soon.
Well, I will recommend a good breeder. I know the one.
Too many big animals around this area for one big dog and one that is a appetizer.
With a loud bark.
Yeah, it's still annoying. It's still annoying. You know?
Well, I tried, Dave. I'm trying to show the good parts of her.
I love her to death. She keeps me warm every night. For those of you who don't know, I do have two dogs. I have a German Shepherd Lab cross. His name is Doug. And I have a little Chihuahua Dachshund cross. Her name is Zero. She's my little baby. She's such a miserable little girl, but she loves me, and she keeps me warm at night. That's all that matters.
Agreed.
Yes. So I do show her love. I do show her love. You know, that's what it's all about. When you are having a first-time experience, the panic sets in. You saw it with me personally. What would be your advice to someone who, let's say, has not had an experience yet, but wants to prepare for having that experience, just in case it comes?
Well, the first thing I'd recommend they do is visualization within your mind. Okay, what kind of beings do you speculate you could encounter? What are the places you speculate you could meet them? If you're able to create a visualization within your mind, you're creating almost like a pathway that your mind is going to believe will happen. So let's say you've never seen any... Give me a group here, Dave.
Arcturians.
Perfect. Let's say you've never met an Arcturian, but you've been spending a month doing meditations where you're hoping to get in contact with the Arcturians. So I would visualize, like, let's say you do your meditations every day at home in your living room. I'd visualize myself sitting in the living room and an Arcturian being showing up, and I'd visualize them, let's say, coming in from the doorway. And first, you'd want to feel, okay, well, what does their energy feel like? Because when you start to actually close your eyes and meditate and feel what their energy feels like, you will have Arcturian energy coming in around you. And then the next thing that would happen is I'd be like, okay, so what do they look like? Okay, see what they look like. What is the Arcturian doing? You need to actually prepare yourself for what you suspect they would do. And always think about the encounter in a very loving way if you're wanting to make positive contact. The reason why is if you're creating within your mind the understanding that the contact with this being is going to be positive, you are very likely to get that out of it. But if you just get too excited and go, oh my God, there's an alien in my bedroom, then you're probably not going to get a lot out of it, because you're not going to be able to get out of the, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. It's just a matter of really programming your mind.
But for a lot of people, though, that's going to be intimidating if it's their first time. Because the funny thing that I see a lot of on social media, and I've had people say this on the air as well or in our chat rooms, is they're so pumped up. They're like, I'm so ready for this. I am so prepared. I know I'm going to have my camera ready. I'm going to have my video camera ready. I'm going to be playing my Rocky theme song in the background. All right, Adrian, you know how it goes. Right? Yep. And everybody says they're prepared.
Well,
but the funny part, sorry for cutting you off. I had to cough there for a quick second. The funny part about it is you're not prepared. I always get to ask that question almost like you have the 1,000-foot stare of a worn in veteran in the military, in the Army or the Marines or something along those lines. And I always say, do you really believe you're going to act like that? How are you going to act? Well, I'm going to... And this is where the answer just gets blown out of proportion.
I agree. One thing that I've noticed a lot of extraterrestrials do prior to actually making contact with you is they will observe you for days or weeks or even months ahead of time. So when I first moved to Mission, I would notice craft energy going along... Dave, you're in my townhouse, along three sides of my townhouse, the top section, the far, like, the long section, and the back section by the field. I feel the energy moving all over, really gauging, okay, where is she picking up on us? How is she feeling? If she's on the top floor, is she scared if we're right above the house? Okay, if she's in the kitchen, is she afraid when she can feel the craft right here? I know that sounds weird, but that's part of the way that they get you used to their energy. Another way that they can actually tend to get used to their energy when they're wanting to make contact with you is that you may see invisible outlines moving around your house. You may wonder, okay, well, what's an invisible outline? Let's say you're looking straight ahead across your room, and you see, even out of your eyes, looking straight, a part of something move for a moment, like let's say the outline of a head and shoulders move from the lamp over towards a chair, there for a minute, gone, or even like a hazy outline that's there for a minute, or and like let's say an orb of energy or a bunch of sparks. Those can be the energy beings walking around within your visual field. Now, the reason why I bring that up is I had a lot of energy like that around my house. The night before, my Arcturian brother, Danny, ended up coming to me and really giving me that very, very in-your-face contact on my bed, which we'll have to go into next time, Dave. Mm-hmm. It's amazing how they do things like that. They don't often like to just jump out and scare you out of the middle of nowhere, because that's not really beneficial for them if you're in a panicky type state.
Sharon has one final question for us tonight, because that's all we have time for.
Mm-hmm.
What do extraterrestrials think of our pets?
Well, it depends. I know my fish, they seem to be quite fond of. I know my German Shepherd, well, because she now sleeps in my room and beside my bed, the amount of beings that I see in my room has gone down exponentially. They will wait until I'm on the other side quite often. When I was very sick and on the island and my dog was not sleeping by my bed, they would come into my room because she wasn't near me. But they do tend to be a little more afraid of most dogs. I don't have cats, so I can't say about cats.
Cats don't care about anything. They're just pissed off to be breathing. They're just, you know, I have no respect for cats.
Oh, I love cats.
Oh, yeah, this is where you and I will agree to disagree on that. They're just pissed off.
Maybe cast it someday.
Well, you know what? With my luck, I probably would. I'm gonna be honest with you. You know, and I'll tell you right now, no extraterrestrial is scared of my dogs. They let them right in. I don't know how many times Mrs. S.O.R. has been woken up and seen beings standing in our doorway. And it usually happens a couple times a week, and the dogs do nothing about it. It's like they made peace with them.
I think that could be the case with yours, but you have to remember, Dave, my dog was purchased for the sole intention of protecting me. That is her job.
I can understand that. I can understand that, but that's what, also what I got Doug for as well.
Well, I don't know. I haven't seen them go near mine. So I'm not quite sure what to say regarding that. Sorry.
Well, what do you do? What do you do?
Laugh and enjoy the ride.
Exactly. On that note, I have fired up the Bumblefoot. We got 3 minutes left in tonight's broadcast. Samantha Mowat, thank you so much for being on the show. I hope you had a good time tonight.
I did, Dave. Thank you so much. And by the way, to all your listeners, this month I will be having a bunch of videos going out onto YouTube, so please be sure to look for Samantha Mowat on YouTube, and I'm going to be releasing a series of videos about psychic abilities, how you can develop them, as well as the correlation between that and extraterrestrial contact, the over 400 encounters that I've had, in detail with drawings for a good chunk of them, so please feel free to check that out.
Thank you, Samantha. Once again, Samantha's website is Samantha Mowat, Mowat spelled M-O-W-A-T, .ca, SamanthaMowat.ca. Samantha, you hold on for a couple of minutes, and I'm going to wrap up the show tonight. Thank you so much for being with us. SHR Media Network, Spaced Out Radio's chat room on Spreaker, Paranormal Forum, and on Facebook, Euphoria Chronicles, and everyone taking part in the SOR Space Travelers. If you're listening to this show and you want to ask questions, hop into Facebook if you're on there. Join the Space Travelers Club and join us. It's a great crew in there. You want to be a part of that. And
talking to you.
It was very nice talking to you as well, Samantha. Thank you so much. So, Remember, we're going to be back here in 21 hours. If you're on Twitter, follow us at Spaced Out Radio. Give our Facebook page a like, Spaced Out Radio Show. You can join our Spaced Out Radio group as well. On Instagram, I can be followed at Dave Scott, S-O-R. Our YouTube channel, where we store our archives, like this show, in about 15, 16 hours, Spaced Out Radio Show. Click the subscribe button for that. Our website, once again, is spacedoutradio.com. Tomorrow night on the show, the Crypto Guru, Ronald Murphy, is back. Werewolves and Dogman. We're going to rock it out with the Bumblefoot. Little Brother is watching. Our music man, the guitar god, ripping it up right now. Good night.